Welcome to Podcastville. The Church of What's Happening Now is brought to you by 5-4. Let me tell you something. Throw out the stigma that being well-dressed will cost you a fortune. At 5-4 Club, they found a way to make great-looking clothes affordable for everyone. 5-4 Club understands that your time is extremely valuable. Why waste it at the mall or wandering around stores? You get $100 worth of clothes for $60 a month. You can pause or cancel at any time. And as a 5-4 Club member, you'll receive 50% off items on their online shop and access to exclusive members-only items, free shipping, and size exchanges. You know your Uncle Joey takes care of you. Go to 54club.com right now and enter the promo code Joey, and they'll give you 50% off your first month package plus a pair of sunglasses, all right? That's 54club, spelled F-I-V-E-F-O-U-R, club.com. Number two, are you hiring? Do you know where to post your job to find the best candidates? You know how hard it is to find your people in today's society? In fact, 80% of employers who post jobs on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate through the site within one day. ZipRecruiter understands your problems, and that's why they're going to offer something to the church. Find out today why ZipRecruiter has been used by businesses of all sizes to find the most qualified job candidates with the immediate results. And right now, my listeners can post jobs on ZipRecruiter for free. Nothing. Ugats. That's free. Just go to ZipRecruiter.com/church. That's ZipRecruiter.com/church. It's September, cocksuckers. Kick that muley. Ain't nobody deaf here. The Church of What's Happened Now. Dean Del Rizzi, better yet, Sugarless Dean Del Rizzi, and my main Christ killer, Lee Syatt. Here we go. Kick that muley. 1981, a masterpiece.
Yo, bitchin'!
So make your move!
You make me!
Church of What's Happening Now, greetings, happy Labor Day. I hope you had a great summer, but guess what? It's over, cocksuckers. It's time to fucking buckle up the fucking belt and get to working, because Christmas is right around the corner. No more fucking around. I don't want to see nothing but assholes and elbows. You understand me? Straight to the 26th, and then you can take some fucking time off. Dean Del Rizzi, always one of the hardest working men in show business. If he's not doing any drunk, he's at the stand. He's at a Bruce Springsteen concert. He don't give a fuck. He's interviewing the guy from the Grateful Dead at the studio. This motherfucker don't stop. And he's 52 years old, so get your shit together. And my co-host, the man of steel, the man of many fucking ideas, Mr. Lee Syatt.
How you doing, buddy?
You know me, dog. Tip-top Magoo. Had a nice weekend at the beach with the family.
You always have good luck. You go to the beach the hottest weekend of the year.
No, I go when it's cloudy and cold. I did the math. I did the fucking math. It don't take a swami to be from salami. You know what I'm saying? I'm sitting at the Ontario Improv. It's Friday night. I'm in between two shows, and KTL News comes on at 10, or whatever the fuck it is, 9 o'clock, which comes on a little earlier. One of those KTLA, one of those fucking Puerto Rican stations. Yeah. And I start watching, and they show the weather that week before. And it's saying, like, it's 106 on Tuesday, but it's going to be between the 105 and 110 range.
Fuck.
So I looked at all this, and I fucking sat there, and I scratched my head, and I go, listen, there's nothing I hate more than sitting around. And the worst weeks of the fucking year in this town are the week before Thanksgiving. No, I'm wrong. I'm sorry. The week before the 4th of July, the week before Labor Day, and the fucking week after Christmas. you want to shoot yourself in this town.
Yeah. It's fucking zero emails, zero no calls. Emails,
nobody calls. You basically wake up to do spots at the Comedy Store.
That's it.
Nobody takes meetings. Nobody has auditions. It drives you fucking nuts. This is why this year I hit the Portland on the 27th of December.
Yeah.
And I do Tuesday and Wednesday, and I'm back home by Thursday, and New Year's could suck my dick.
That fucking club's That's, great.
That club
too.
Is great. Two Ooh. Days after Christmas, everybody's got money in their pockets.
Yeah.
Everybody's got their burn
a Extra
hole.
Family in town. Extra they want to get out of the house.
They want to get out of the house. So that, you know, you gotta plan your way around it. Don't take a fucking genius. So the same thing. I said, that's it. This week here, I had jujitsu, I had writing, I had a couple things, and I had like two spots. And I'm like, what am I going to do?
Yeah.
The store called me. I took Sunday night because it was a holiday Monday. I knew it was going to be fire.
That was great.
It doesn't take a genius to let you know that.
Yep.
So I took Friday and Saturday and Thursday. I took the wife down to fucking one of those beaches. Hermosa, one of those fucking beaches.
Right, Huntington.
Huntington.
Yeah.
And we just went online. You know, I called two of my friends. I go, where should I go? And they said, Bob, Bob. And one guy said, well, you know what? Huntington's more kid-oriented. So we went online, we got a hotel, and we looked at it. It had like six pools for kids and all this shit. And we fucking got three nights down there, and we shot down there, and the kid didn't get sick, and it was just, I was fucking blown away by Huntington Beach.
Yeah.
Like, I was blown away.
I fucking flew over that shit Saturday night.
Oh, did you? You were saying in the fucking helicopter.
Oh, man. It fucking Burr, you know? He hits me up, he says, hey, we're going to take a helicopter to San Diego, the gig. It's 4 hours traffic, you know. So we're going to helicopter there. And I get to the thing, and then I realize, oh, he's going to be flying it.
I would have shit my pants. It was just you and him?
Three other people, too. It was a six-seater. So his instructor was there, and then his instructor's girlfriend and buddy. And this thing was like a fucking the limousine of helicopters, and then there's Burr, we lift off, we just fucking take off, and I'm thinking, well, you know, he's my great friend and he's one of the greatest comics, but I've never seen him fly a helicopter, and none of my friends fly a helicopter, and it's my first time in a copter. I'm like, whoa!
Yeah, I would have wanted the instructor to drive or fly. I would have been like, yeah, maybe let him fly.
No, I was into it. I was like, Burr, like Bruce Dickinson, man. Burr was flying us to the gig, you know, Maiden! and we were flying over those mansions in Huntington and Hermosa all the way down the coastline, man. Just seeing the most incredible architecture, and then all the fucking people with the beaches and shit. And we were there in 56 minutes. It goes 135 miles an hour. 56 minutes flying.
And you came back at night.
And then we came back at night, which was scarier.
Scary as fuck, yeah.
Yeah, because the helicopter has these panoramic floor-to-ceiling windows. The doors are just windows. They're not like a door. So at night, it looks like you're just like leaning onto the sky. Nope. You can't see.
I would have got sick.
Oh, man. I was fucking sick. I actually loved it so much that I was up all night buzzing from it. And then the show was fire.
It's funny because when you told me what had happened, I could tell why Burr is so good as a comic.
Yeah.
You know? I talked to him 7 years ago on a plane, and he was trying to learn Spanish.
Yeah, yeah.
He's always trying to entertain his mind with something else, and that's a sign of a comic that came to a stress level one day and said, whoa, 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 whoa. I need to get a fucking hobby, and we all do it.
Yeah.
There comes one day in your career at the 16th, it's maybe at the 19-year mark, that you go, you know what, man? I can't have another conversation about fucking comedy again.
Yeah, right.
I got to get new friends.
Yeah.
And you start dabbling outside, because for the first 15 years, that's all you lived around.
Yeah.
Is comics. You dated comics. You hung out with comics. You ate with comics. You lived with comics.
Eat shit, breathe.
Yeah, you fucking eat shit, breathe it. And then one day you go, I can't do this no more.
Yeah.
It's really like it hits you. You're like, I can't hear one more Kennison story. I can't hear one more of this story. And you find a hobby.
Yep.
To take your mind away from the pictures and the emails and the people telling you that the podcast is great, because if not, you'll lose your fucking mind.
Yeah,
you really need something to ground you.
Totally.
He chose driving a fucking helicopter. that's almost as scary as doing stand-up.
Fuck yeah.
Like I said, once you do stand-up,
oh, yeah.
In your mind, you're like, I can do anything. You know what I'm saying? Right. Fucking helicopter, I'll give it a shot, you know?
I can't believe it, though. You know, it's so crazy. Like, you got the foot pedal stuff, which operate, you know, it's all this kind of shit. So the, you know, the top propeller is doing this and this, and then the back ones are doing this, and your foot and your joystick, you know, it's like, it's fucking impressive, man, you know? It's, I mean, that shit is crazy.
You know, like, when you look at the comics that came before us, like the legends, like, Richard Pryor and
Carlin
and the other guy that I like, Lenny Bruce, their hobbies were drugs.
Yep.
And that was my hobby for a long time. And if you look at it, that's why I never fucking made it forward. My hobbies were drugs.
Yeah. You consider it a hobby?
It was a hobby.
Yeah, yeah. Oh,
God. Listen, I'm writing this book right now, and I'm in chapters that now, as I'm writing it, I see why I was the way I was. I was telling Lee, when I was 19, if I didn't have coke, I didn't go out of the house that night. I was like, oh,
yeah, it's boring.
It was boring. If there wasn't coke there, I wouldn't go there. Like, anybody gonna have a package there? Yeah, Lee's gonna bring a little. Okay, let's go down there. At least we'll get something to get the party going.
So, what would you do at home?
Watch TV. I knew I was dead anyway.
Just fry out.
Yeah. So if I had to stay home, I accepted it by 6, 7.
Yeah.
And by sometimes you got to call at 9:38. What are you doing? Can you get an 8-ball? Bam! I'm in business. I got at least a half gram coming to me. Plus, he'll turn me on to a couple lines. I'll come back, jerk off, watch TV, and call it a night. You know what I'm saying? But at least I got high.
Do drug dealers ever, like, fake being out of it? Like, does it doesn't make sense, almost. Like, why would you be out of this? You know people, like, really want it.
Well, people you know, fucking sell out.
People ran out of blow, all the time. That was brutal.
Well, it's selling out.
On a Friday fucking night at 3:30 in the morning.
Yeah.
You went over there, like, we have no more. And you're like, okay, let's get in the car. And you went and hunted guy number two. You always had three fucking drug dealers.
Guy number two had shitty stuff.
And then
stuff.
You got another guy. You had two guys. Yeah. And Dean had two guys.
Yep.
So if us three ran out, if I ran out of blow, I had four options. One of you guys could still make a call.
Yeah, yeah.
So you never ran out of blow. We always knew one guy. But this guy's down in Marina Del Rey visiting his grandmother. He said we could come by. That's a 40-minute drive. Okay, fuck it. Okay. Looks like we're going to Marina Del Rey at 4 in the morning.
With a 12-pack. Always in my ride.
With the fucking music blasting, waiting for a cop to pull you over.
Totally. So,
you know how, like, sometimes when there's a disaster or something, gas prices will go up? You know when they, like, find bail? Like, they have a big cocaine bust? Does that make prices go up in your area?
Okay, in 85... It's funny because the narcos mentioned it, but I always knew about this. In 81, it was 100.
Yep.
It was 100 straight up, 50 for a half gram. Some motherfuckers charged you 60.
Yeah. No breaks, 350, 8-ball.
Right. Some guys cut it and it was 90 and 45.
Right.
But that's a nightmare because they either show up with 40 or 50. And now you lost an extra $5 because people love showing up with 40. I'll catch you next time. There ain't no next time.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? There ain't no next time. Who the fuck are you?
Drug dealing.
It's drug dealing. But let me tell you what happened that's interesting. And they mentioned on Narcos in 85, Bush, or whoever was president, Reagan. Declared war on him. And he sent the troops to Colombia. But it was too late. By that time, Carlos Leder was processing coke in Cuba.
Yeah.
But the big problem was, cocaine was very easy to bring into the States. The problem they were having was getting the ether into Colombia. Because you needed the ether alcohol for the wash. That's what gave it that fucking...
Yeah.
When you get cocaine with the ethers right, and you snort that motherfucker that goes down your throat, Lee Syatt, good googly moogly.
That's best. And you couldn't wash it in America?
Not with... No.
No.
At that time, they weren't that process. That was part of the process.
Gotcha.
So the biggest problem was getting the fucking ether into Colombia. So they started washing it with turpentine.
Yeah, gasoline.
Gasoline.
That's the shit. That's why I think people have Parkinson's now. A lot of the people, because of what they were washing it with. You know, they fucking look at heavy blowheads, like, you know, Pryor and the dude from fucking Family Ties. You know, all these people do a lot of blow, and it seems like they got Parkinson's. And, you know, they say, like, gasoline, you know, aluminum, Because they would cut it with aluminum, too, to like hardeners. And aluminum, you know, they say like you use it in your deodorant, you can get, you know, Parkinson's disease and shit. It's fucking crazy, right?
It's crazy.
They're just mixing it with anything that'll work. You know what I mean? That's fucking, you know, jungle chemist.
But when that shit happened from 85 to 86, cocaine prices were 18 to 2,000 an ounce.
Okay.
And it was tremendous cocaine. But that means if you sold the whole bag intact, you made $800 profit.
How much were you making before?
I mean, before, you should make $1,000. You cut it a little bit. That would increase it to about $1,500. You took a little bit for yourself and put it on your girlfriend's fucking monkey and ate it. All right? That was the deal. Cocaine was so fucking high. It was anywhere from $1,800 to $2,000 because the coke that they had the ether. Yeah. Was expensive. The shit that tasted like cat piss was 14.
Yeah.
And they re-rocked it, so it took the cat piss smell away. But the next day, yeah, you had a headache that was fucking horrible.
It was yellow, too. It wasn't white. Like, I like that fucking white shale, abalone shell-looking shit where you chip the rock and it was bluish. It looked like a bone. That shit is great. I remember reading this one thing where Ozzy said, yeah, man, I was... you know, hooked on blow, and we went and played at Rock in Rio in Brazil, and a gram was $10, and that was for the tourist. It was $5 for the locals for a gram. Man, I would have died if it was $10 a gram. You know what I mean? Fuck you. Because I think that's why you don't die. You run out of money. You know what I mean? And you run out of blow.
I tell you what, I'm just happy it got out of my life, man.
Yeah, me too.
I'm happy it disappeared and never came back to catch me or even torment me. When I was done, I was done.
Me too. Me too.
You know, and you were scared for the first 6 months. You're like, I might fucking get a package.
Yeah, yeah.
But nah, when you're done, you're done.
Yeah, you are.
So we're really lucky on that. It's funny you mentioned Ozzy Osbourne. He was, when I heard he had a band called The Blizzard, because at one time he took a picture like in 76.
Yeah.
With Black Sabbath, but he had a white shirt and it said the Blizzard of Oz on it.
That's what you're saying, yeah.
And I went nuts. When I saw that shirt, that gave me a green light to snort with three hands. You know, Snowblind already had me all fucked up. Yeah. But now he was talking about it. And then Clapton song.
Slow cocaine.
Then I went to see Nazareth, and Nazareth did a cover of it during their tour 1 year in 82.
Wow.
It was fucking one of the best versions of cocaine I ever heard. Acoustic.
Wow.
Acoustic Nazareth. You know?
That guy's voice was incredible.
For that jam, for that song, he was really fucking good that night. I wasn't a big, big fan of that guy.
Oh, I love that guy.
I liked Telegram and Telegraph, whatever the fuck it was. There was a couple jams he had that were all right, but after three or four songs, he got on my fucking nerve.
Hair of the Dog, man.
Hair of the Dog. Fuck. That was a popular fucking album.
Yeah.
You know, we grew up around good music. We were very fortunate that
super
even the bad bands had three or four good fucking jams, you know?
Yeah.
I still remember thinking that, fuck, a year ago I was listening to The Wall, and now I'm listening to Hall & Oates. I can't go for that.
Yeah. Yeah, right?
And I'm enjoying it. I can't lie to you, you know.
I was listening to REO Speedwagon today.
Yeah, that's a great album. That's one they did in 81,
big
whatever.
One. Huge.
That's a great album.
High Infidelity.
Yeah. You know, I still listen to Greg Kinn.
Oh.
If I hear Jeopardy.
Oh, I had him on the podcast.
Or the other one, I fucking go nuts. Oh, what a sweetheart of a guy.
That guy's a fucking soldier.
I was supposed to do this Cobbs.
Yeah.
And I got a radio request to do Greg Kinn. I'm looking at the name, and I'm like, nah.
Yeah.
And I call up and I go, listen, before the interview even starts, are you the guy in 1982? And he goes, yep. And I go, let me tell you something. I went to see you.
Yeah.
I forget who he opened for. He opened like for the Go-Go's or something.
Yeah,
like
right.
That. It was somebody like that effect. But he had two jams that were tremendous.
That guy's fucking great. I had him on a year ago. He was playing the Whiskey. I interviewed him at the hotel for 2 hours. Fucking stories galore. Lots of blow. Told great blow stories. Then I went to the Whiskey and watched him. His son's in the band. And they're fucking tearing it up. Where were you when I needed you? You know, and he got all that big money again when fucking, what's his name? I lost on Jeopardy. You know, Al Yank at Weird Al did his song, and he got big bump again in cash. And then he got divorced and divorced, and you know, but fuck, he's out there doing it still.
He was that song, all those songs.
Yeah, yeah.
Fucking had me. What did I fucking hear today that was like, Jesus, this still rings all over 20 years? Human League.
Oh, yeah.
Don't You Want Me, Baby.
Oh, I love that one.
I fucking, every time I hear that song, 2 minutes singing, I get goosebumps, and no matter what I'm thinking about or what I'm doing, I think of a certain time in my life, a night where I was at a club in the city.
Yeah.
I didn't graduate high school, but all my friends had. I was supposed to graduate, but I dropped out.
Yeah.
And we're all in the city, we're all ate a lewd. And this was a club that was 3 floors, and every floor was different. So the first floor was like rock music.
Right.
The second floor was like punk music, and the third floor was disco.
Yeah.
Okay, like where you went up to dance. And to get back down, you had to go down a sliding pond.
Wow.
So it was a pretty cool, and they had mattresses on the side because people would get fucked up. It was called like the Fun House.
Yeah.
All right, Madonna used to always go there and sing in 83 and 82. Wow. There was a couple places she would go to. This was one of them. And I didn't, listen, guys, I'm not telling you this story because I hung out at this place. We had just graduated high school. I was making a ton of money robbing on the street, robbing drug dealers. Everybody was a drug dealer.
Yeah.
At least I had would come to me when they go, can I talk to you for a second? My brother just called me. He's got a kilo of coke in the house. You know anybody who wants it? No, I don't. And guess what I did in 2 days?
Robbed that house.
Robbed Lee's her brother's house. Because they didn't know what they were doing. They put it under the bed.
Yeah.
And go get a sandwich and leave the back window open. Like, that's how it was, Lee. Everybody said, wait a second. They went home, they did the math, and they said, I could do that.
Yeah.
I could sell coke.
Right.
Wait a second. All I got to do is go to the Comedy Store with an ounce and bag it up and sell it for $100 and unload it. I could sit there all night and just sell it to comics.
Yeah.
Not one cop. You go to the Comedy Store back in the 80s,
yeah,
you would sell an ounce a night.
My buddy sold blow
5 nights
at
a week,
the store in the 80s, and that's how I started hanging there. He'd be like, we got to stop here. And we'd pop in, and my other buddy was dating the head waitress, and I'd be watching comedy in the main room, and he'd go, I'm done. And then we'd just drink there all night. Just fucking coked up, drinking. Stay at that Riot House next door for like $87. Up all night, drinking fucking rum and doing sacks of blow at the store, man, in the 80s.
It's crazy.
I know, right? Guy's in prison right now.
Yeah, I was going to say, how many people are in prison then?
Yeah.
Just for like, oh, my buddy asked, so I started selling him coke, and it just sort of happened.
Well, you know, man, as with anything else, things get sloppy.
Yep.
Especially if you start doing the powder. Like, if you're a businessman and you're like, I just move it, which means you're getting the kilos for $16.5, you're chopping them up and you're giving them to Lee, and Lee gives you $28,000 per.
Yeah.
That's it. That's
just,
what you
it's just
do.
Just an exchange.
Nobody knows nothing. And then once you get Lee, you get another guy like Lee. And you get 3 Lees, 4 Lees, 5 Lees, 6 Lees, and guess what, Lee? He's making $60,000 a month, and he doesn't even have to talk to anybody. His only fear is you getting arrested and ratting.
Yeah, and that's what happens.
You're cool. You have Dean. Dean's a musician. Dean goes out every night. You give Dean the grams already cut up and measured. You give Dean 28, and Dean gives you back 1500. And Dean will come over 4 nights a week and keep you in pork chops and chocolate cake for the rest of your fucking life. Again, now you got to get 4 Deans.
How much does Dean make?
Don't worry about what Dean makes.
Yeah.
Dean makes 28, take away 15. 1,300.
Okay.
Dean's not going to make 1,300 because he needs 3 of those grams to sell that coke. Dean is a businessman. Dean needs a couple grams for himself. He's going to sell a gram to a girl, bring her home, rob her, get his dick sucked, and put her on her way. It's a fucking lifestyle.
Yeah.
You go to a place, everybody at that place knows you. As soon as somebody comes up to you and says, hey, my friend wants to buy 2 ounces of blow, you go home, you light everything on fire,
yep,
you throw away your fucking scale, and you don't know nothing for a month. You disconnect all your numbers, and you start all over again in 6 months.
What does that lifestyle mean? What do you mean? It's a lifestyle.
Well, you know what? Those dealers on the low level, they become like these small-minded rock stars where they're got so many people like they love the attention, you know, like they're nobody, and then all of a sudden they're like, I go in this bar, everybody wants to talk to me, and they get addicted to that, you know, that fucking that thing of like, he's here.
I still talk to two of my ex-drug dealers, and I've been clean from cocaine 9 years. Yeah. I talked to two out of the three of them that I had. I had four. I still talk to two out of the four. The one guy is a smart motherfucker, and he always was. He always was since day one. That's why I hooked up with him. I liked what he did. He wasn't reckless. He was a boozer.
Yeah.
But he wouldn't answer the phone those 2 days. He's one of those guys.
Yep.
That it's 2 days. Yeah. And after a day, I knew that he was fucked up on the couch like Denzel. He would get fucked up like Denzel. He's black.
In Man on Fire.
So I would have to go over there and knock on the door. Not regular
Denzel. Yeah.
I would knock on the door, and he'd kind of get up and ask me what I was doing. And I go, come on, dog, I love you. What I tell you, don't come over here when I don't answer the fucking phone. What do you want, motherfucker? Come on, just give me 2 grams. You got my money? I'm 10 short. See? You come over here when I'm fucked up trying to relax and shit.
And 10 short.
10 short.
Yeah.
But he always gave it to me. And then I had the Armenian guy. And I always talk to him because he's got kids.
Yeah.
And we cross paths now all the time.
Oh, wow.
So we talk on the sly.
He's still dealing?
Yes.
Wow, that's hot.
Tremendous.
Yeah.
But he has his own little Armenian crew.
Yeah.
He gets it from his little Armenian drug lords over there in Glendale.
Yeah.
And he just sells to Armenians. He says he doesn't even go over the hill anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
He doesn't go to El Compadre no more.
Yeah.
But he's got a nice car. He's got nice clothes. He goes away on the weekends. You know, he shares the kids with his wife.
Yeah.
So when he goes, he goes. He's another guy that he starts on Friday. And he'll call me on Sunday and go, I was just thinking about you, because I saw the show joke on Showtime about it.
Yeah, yeah.
I used to have a whole bit about him.
Yeah.
Because I had been here for probably 10 years. No, I'm lying to you. I got here in 97. I met those cats in about 99. And before that, I had pussies for drug dealers. Oh, I had this white dude they called White Lightning.
White Lightning.
He was a half a fag.
Terrible.
And I had this other dude who always fucking complained he was a Jew. And Jesus Christ, you know, it was always a fucking deal. He lived right in Hollywood by the Guitar Center.
Oh, yeah.
And there was always a problem. And he was from New York, and he was cool. But I had to say something to him one day, like, brother, you're a coke dealer.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. Why do you get mad when we fucking call you? It was always a bad time. And when I get with people who would buy from him, they'd always come to me and go, what's his problem? I go, I don't know. You introduced me to him.
Yeah.
I don't know what his fucking problem is. Like, he makes you feel bad
about what are you calling me for?
Why are you calling me at 4 in the afternoon? Yeah. Why are you calling me at 1 in the afternoon?
Yeah, yeah.
Why are you calling me at 8:30 in the afternoon? Because we want to buy fucking blow.
Yeah.
So I got rid of that fucking guy. I had nobody.
Fucking White Lightning.
And then I met the brothers up by the Martel Cartel.
Yeah.
I met them through White Lightning, as a matter of fact. White Lightning took me over to them one day and said, listen, I'm going out of commission for a few weeks. I'm going underground. Hang out with the Martel Cartel. And it was two of the biggest, blackest, ugliest motherfuckers you saw in your life.
Yeah.
And the first couple times I went over there, it wasn't no love between us. They would search me and shit.
Oh, yeah.
And make me feel fucked up.
They would say, you wearing a wire?
Nah, they would go, you coming over here telling us you're Cuban and shit. You're really one of those mafia motherfucking informants and shit. Yeah. You're so on A&E and shit. And they would bust my balls. And I went over there about 4 or 5 times. And then I went over there a 6th time, and they were all stitched up.
Yeah.
Including the white dude. They were stitched up. And I had cash, and as I'm buying the coke, I go, I got to ask you guys a question. What the fuck happened to you guys?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And they said, man, these black motherfuckers came over here the other day and fucking tied us up and took our shit.
Wow.
So we started going back and forth. At the time, I had found a gun.
You found a gun.
And I lived in... At
sure, Ralph, we'll just skip over that.
And yeah. I lived at the... And
I love that one.
And I lived at the Ralphie May building.
Yeah, oh yeah, over there.
Over there,
that's where my crew lives. Over Steve there. Henry, Lucas Earl.
That whole building?
Yeah.
Behind El Compadre?
Oh, no. What's the one you lived over there by the one by the hostel?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I lived there. This was way before the hostel.
Oh, okay.
The hostel was when I stayed there when it was a hotel.
Right.
And then I moved by the hostel.
Right.
In 2000.
In that apartment building.
In August of 2000.
Right.
With my girlfriend at the time. But before that, what were we talking about, Ralphie May?
What? Yeah, I thought he lived in there, too.
No, he lived
in a different building.
We all lived on Schrader. No, 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 no. Yeah, it was Schrader.
Yep.
Isn't Schrader next? The Guitar Center Schrader?
It's like Orange.
Vista.
Yeah.
You got Vista, Sierra Bonita, yeah. And Curzon.
Right.
And whatever that street is
right.
There.
Right.
There were four streets. No, those are, guys, if you don't know Hollywood, that's those four little streets there. If you live in between that,
it's dark in
your
there.
Life is complete. You got a gym.
Yeah.
You got Justin's Fortune's gym. You got that Italian place that makes pizzas on the corner.
You got Guitar Center.
You got Guitar Center, which is a fucking, listen, you don't know what fun is till you go to the Guitar Center.
Oh, I love
and
it.
And just sit watching behind fools the drums in there. And shit. Yeah. Or heavy metalists go in there with tight pants.
I always say if you want to pick up on a chick, just go in there because the dumbass boyfriend brings him in there, and the boyfriend's just playing in his own world. And the girl's just like, oh, God, you're never going to be in a band. And you just roll up and go, hey, you want to get lunch? And just move on.
Take him right to the Sunset Grill.
Right there.
What Don Emily sang about.
Yep.
That's a fucking crazy neighborhood there. But that building there used to be fucking hell.
Yeah.
It used to be. I don't know. How did we start talking about that building?
I don't know. We were talking about those guys got robbed.
Yeah, they got robbed.
Yeah.
So I found the gun in that building.
Oh, yeah.
And there was a chick that lived in the building that you could go to a house. Right, God rest her soul. She just died about 6 months ago. So I took the bathroom mirror off, the one that stayed on the wall.
Yeah.
And it had a medicine cabinet. I put the gun back there, and I never used it. I wiped my prints off it, and I just saved it back there for a rainy day.
Yeah.
And fucking, I found like three guns in that building.
Really?
Anyway, yeah, it was tremendous.
Wow.
Anyway.
I hate to be rude, but is that how she died? By leaving guns all around her building?
No. She died by a different gun, alcoholism. So I went over there, and I like these black dudes.
Yeah.
I like black people. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to see them get beat up and jumped. So I went over there the next day, and I go, listen, bro, I don't know you. You don't know me, but here. How the fuck do you people sell drugs? They ain't got a gack around this motherfucker. You know, that's 101.
Yeah. There's a drop right here.
I got two black guys and a white one. Let the white guy hold the fucking peace.
Yep.
That's it. Anything happens, the white guy shooting. You fucking, you gotta, and but they had, the whole security system was bad.
Yeah.
I'm like, you gotta close that door and have them buzz in. They had the thing that you walk in. I go, close that door. Well, I don't give a fuck what people like. You guys want to sell, blow and be successful.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I'd rather make the DEA jump over the fence than just walk in.
Yeah.
That extra 2 minutes, one of them getting caught on the barbed wire.
Flush.
That saves me. That gives me a flush, even though they shut the water off.
Yeah.
When they raid you. You know that, right, Lee?
Yeah.
So before they raid you, they shut the water off.
Oh,
half hour before they raid you. That's how you know you're getting raided.
Yeah.
You turn on the water and there's no water. You better take that blow and light it on fire.
So, if you're like a big guy, do you have someone like just doing the water every 20 minutes? Just like,
what do you mean?
To turn check if you're getting raided.
No, in the morning. Because they're going to raid you at 6 in the morning to catch you off guard.
You wake up to piss, you
flush.
That's
true.
Yeah, they catch you early in the morning, so you're not going to wake up. They know you wake up at 9. So they'll shut the water off at a quarter to fucking 6 and lay the warrant on you. At 6 o'clock, they're knocking on your fucking door.
Fuck. That's
and then
scary.
The Armenian, I never liked, I swear to God, I was a coke fiend.
Yeah.
And I lived on Vista with Josh Wolf.
Yeah.
And I would detest El Compadre.
Oh, yeah.
Detest it.
You don't like it?
At that time.
Oh, okay.
There was something about it that wouldn't make me go in there. And the truth of the matter was, I didn't want to see my uncle.
Yeah.
When my uncle first, when I came out here in like 75, my uncle played the congas at a Mexican restaurant. And he took me there both of the nights I was in town with him. and they gave me salsa, and I started crying and shit. I was like seven, dog.
Yeah, yeah.
They gave me like the hottest salsa they had with jalapeno juice and shit in it.
Fucking with you?
Yeah, it went through my skin. I think I touched my dick. I cried for like 4 days. But I thought it was El Compadre, and I go, what if I go in and he's playing the congas? I'm going to hit him in the head with a bottle. And then people kept telling me, dog, there's a dude that has got good fucking blow, and he gets coked up and just gives you like a gram and a half for $30. And he's Armenian. I went in there one day, and boom, there he was. And
wow.
I started talking to him, and I liked this guy. He was my type of drug dealer. He would get into fist fights at El Compadre.
Wow.
And say funny things to people. Fuck you. One of the funniest things I ever heard him say was, what's the expression when somebody throws you out of their club?
86th.
One night he was talking to this dude named Eric. Eric kept busting his balls about something, that the coke. And he goes, listen, do you know what? From now on, you're 86 from me.
You're from me.
Yeah,
from me. 80s. You're 86 from me.
You're 86 from me.
Buddy, you're 86 from me.
We jacked up one night to the gills with some broads, and he's telling him he's going back to school on Monday. I never laughed so hard in my life. And these three white chicks bought the story, hook, line, and sinker. I'm on the floor fucking rolling.
Yeah.
I loved him. For the first year I did business with him, it was hilarious. If I even thought about getting a package, and I looked at my clock, and it was 3:20, I would call that number, and my brother, he would answer it and go, I'm in your neighborhood. And I go, no, you're not.
Yeah, yeah.
And he goes, yes, come downstairs. I was just thinking about you. Oh. So for 6 months, I would call him at all hours of the night, and he would hit me with the, I was just thinking about you.
Oh, man.
I hadn't heard from you. You know, that type of shit.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Dog, I had to write a bit. He was solid.
Yeah.
I had never had a drug dealer like that. I could call him at 4:45 in the morning, and he would say, are you home? Yes. Give me 15 minutes.
Wow, I love that.
When he was fucking downstairs, he'd beep me. I had a beeper in those days.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd run down. I'd get the powder from him. I could front from him. He was tremendous.
That's great.
And my Showtime thing, El Payaso, that whole 3-minute bit is about him.
Yeah.
So he puts it on with his family, his mother, his father. And all of a sudden I'm saying this, and he turned the volume off.
Oh, shit.
He was all excited at first. He kept saying, look, it's my friend. Yeah, he's talking about me. He's talking about me. And I'm up there saying, yeah, he's got the best coke. He rides a bicycle with a missing pedal. You know, because he is. He's Armenian. He's fucking a nut. He don't give a fuck, Jack.
Yeah.
But those are my two favorite drug dealers. And I still have contact with them. God bless you.
Oh, my God.
Do you send each other, like, birthday cards or something? Like, what do you think?
Nah, me and the black dude call each other for all the holidays. I'm tight with his mother. His mother's a Jehovah's Witness.
That's hilarious.
So whenever he's by his mother's house, he puts his mother on the phone. I never, listen, beside being my drug dealer, he was a friend as much. And I know a lot of people at home don't do drugs and don't understand where I'm coming from. He was my friend because I had an addiction, and he knew it. He didn't help create it.
Yeah.
I couldn't blame him. By the time I met him, I already had the problem. He'd always keep me alive.
Yeah.
Like, even when I owed him hundreds, and I'd go to his house with a bullshit story, I'd bring him like a t-shirt and a hat from the store. He'd go, dog, clean out the fucking grinder. Whatever's in there is yours. And I would clean it out and get 3/4 of a gram and zip out of there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I go, wow, you know. And he always took care of me. And then when I started getting money, dog, I started giving him hats with $500.
Yeah.
Every time he'd see me, I'd give him $500 because I owed him in excess of $2,000. I had him all the way up there.
Wow. Was it weird when you saw them like getting like fancy stuff? Like if you saw a drug dealer get a new car, you're like, fuck, I paid for that car.
Not he still all. Doesn't have a car.
I never even thought of that stuff.
He Ubers everywhere.
I would just ride in the cars with
Before
him.
Before that, he took cabs everywhere.
Yeah.
He takes cabs. He has a white girlfriend to drive him places. He had a little strip club going for a while, like 3 or 4 white strippers that you could tell their dads beat him up. One was missing a tooth. Dog, you laughed. They lived up at the Hollywood Hills.
Yeah.
I would have to go like to...
It's not a funny situation. It's just funny how you describe it.
Like the second year I was dealing with him, he moved out of the Martel cartel because the one black dude, the bigger guy, got a Russian girlfriend. And he went to war with the Russian girlfriend. He moved her in. So he broke away from the Martel cartel, and I went with him. I took his back. He was rogue. And he moved with these three fucking strippers from the valley.
Wow.
Like some dirty fucking strip club up here in Van Nuys or something.
Yeah, there's some dirty ones out there, right?
Whoa. I'd never been up there. And there was two sisters.
I've never been in them, but I'll drive by them and you're just like, look at those places. On Van Nuys
Boulevard?
Yeah.
Where? Because I know the car dealers and shit.
Like they're way out there, I think.
Yeah, they're way out there. And then if you take like a left into the industrial area over there, there's like two, three in the industrial area. You're like, look at these strip joints. Like I was going over there to interview a guy that builds amplifiers. And he goes, you see this strip joint? There's fucking hundreds of people here at night. And it's just in this like... You know, like warehouse.
What's the one next to the Piggly Wiggly?
The Hoggly Woggly?
Yeah. No. Up in fucking the heart of Van Nuys or some bad neighborhood. Reseda.
God, there's
it's good barbecue, but that's a bad strip club. I shot a movie in there.
Yeah, Dr. Hoggly Woggly's?
No, Piggly Wiggly.
Oh, Piggly Wiggly.
One of those fucking things.
It's a I don't know, but there's weird strip joints all over there.
And then you have the one by here that I hear is kind of crazy, but I don't know. But I know, like, John Evan had a jiu-jitsu school in North Hollywood. You know the part of North Hollywood you never go to?
Oh, yeah. Oh, behind, like...
Yeah, that's where they shot Sons of Anarchy and shit like that.
Oh, yeah, over there, yeah.
It's just scary up there.
Yeah, yeah.
He had a jiu-jitsu school back there, and that night, there was a strip club that had a valet in front of it.
Yeah.
This neighborhood's a fucking dump.
Oh, yeah.
But I bet you go up there for $200, they'll give you fucking chlamydia.
Oh, yeah.
They'll suck your dick.
Cheaper than that.
They'll have you scratching for a week. You know what I'm saying?
Fuck yeah, dude. Those joints are weird out there, man.
Yeah, no.
Whenever I drive around out there in the valley, like behind the Burbank Airport or behind the, what's the big Ford dealer over there off of Van Nuys. They're like a famous one. I forget what they're called. They're famous Ford.
Yeah, yeah.
The side streets there, man, is gangster. They're like, I think like 6 years ago, Van Nuys had the murder capital of all of Southern California. Just that area, man. It was like wars going on.
It's scary up there.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's definitely scary up there at night.
Somebody told me they go... Oh, yeah, well...
Remember that little guy on fire on the park bench on Van Nuys Boulevard about 3 years ago?
Just lit him on fire.
Yeah, right around Christmas. A guy was sleeping, waiting for the bus.
You're out of here.
Somebody poured gasoline on him, lit him on fire up there.
Have you guys ever driven around those streets around LAX?
Oh, that shit's crazy, too.
That is crazy.
There's weird strip joints around there, too.
There's probably definitely strip joints.
Yeah.
But when I was in Uber for 2 weeks once.
Yeah.
And like that, we think there's a lot of people living in vans around here. There's like blocks and blocks of people in tents.
Yeah.
And just, it's creepy.
Why do they put like, all right, so you fly to LA, you're here for business, or you're here for a 2-day stay.
Yeah.
You check into the hotel, you call your wife, you kiss her, tell the kids to go to bed. And then you creep over to one of those dirty strip clubs by the airport.
Yeah. They're fucking crazy. They wiped out all those bums, Lee. Somebody bought that property.
Oh, yeah.
You know who bought it? The LA airport. LAX bought it. And there's like thousands of homeless over there sleeping in cars and everything. And they just wiped them all out, said, you're out of here because they're going to make more parking over there, like off-site parking. And man, I was watching them show it on the news. There's fucking thousands of people over there.
It's obviously weird to see, and it makes you uncomfortable sometimes, but I've never been homeless. And then I don't like when they do that, when they go in and they, like, destroy the tents. Throw it away.
Oh, yeah.
They go with forklifts and just destroy
people's shit. They're like, you're
out of here. Yeah, I don't like that.
That's fucking crazy.
What are options, Lee? I mean, you're trying to...
Oh, yeah, no, I get that. You're
trying to beautify a fucking city. You know what I was trying to tell you before? When you're a child, and, you know, it's the same way you look at New York.
Yeah.
It's the same way you look at New York when I pick you up at Kennedy and I take you to, let's say it was 1985, I take you to the Bronx.
Yeah.
And really shock the fuck out of you. After a minute, you're like, where's Times Square?
Yeah, yeah.
Where's the Statue of Liberty? And I'm like, there ain't no Statue of Liberty in my world, cocksucker. You know what I'm saying? Well, when we're growing up on the East Coast, I don't know how we felt, but I saw beaches. And palm trees, and people roller skating down a path or riding a bicycle down a path.
Surfing.
So, surfing. You know, you saw Disneyland, but basically, this is what you see when you're growing up in Jersey.
Yeah.
This is what you think of. So finally, when I was like 7, I came out here. And my uncle lived in Glendale at the time, in a new residential area that they were just building. And he still lives at the same place.
Wow.
40 fucking years later. But it looked different, but for some reason, he worked towards the beach. So the 3 or 4 days I was here, I was down by the beach.
Yeah.
And I got to see the beach from afar, and he would drive on Pacific Coast Highway, and blah, 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 blah. Okay, and this is, I came 2 times while I was a kid. Fast forward to 84, the Olympics were going to be here.
Oh, yeah.
I came back again. This time, I went to his bar on Washington Boulevard, right after Koreatown.
Oh, all right.
Like, yeah. Towards downtown.
Yeah.
Like, if you make a left on that Washington Boulevard, you hit the courtroom. You hit the downtown courthouse and shit like this.
Yeah, yeah.
That is a horrible part of town.
Totally.
So at that time, I come out here in 84, and I still had that vision of Los Angeles and the beaches and, you know, that path with the people riding the bicycle and girls running with bikinis, you know. But now I'm watching the inner guts of Los Angeles.
Yeah.
Which is Washington Boulevard, down the block from Koreatown, which in 1984 was basically a fucking dump.
Yeah, absolutely.
He was surrounded by a bunch of places where you chopped up cars. He just had a Mexican restaurant or a Mexican bar with a little restaurant, and people that were illegal could go in there and pay for a $7 Budweiser with nobody balling him.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He paid the cops off not to come in. So he charged seven of Bud. You know how many people, you know those Budweisers, those Mexican drinks?
Oh, yeah.
My uncle got 2 Mercedes-Benz, his car is paid, his house is paid off.
$7 Budweisers in 84.
But no, my point is that I saw that part of L.A. And I remember looking in the paper and asking around, how do we get to this place? And they're like, you got to take 2 buses. And then you have to, and I'm like, fuck this place. First of all, this place looks like a bomb. It's like if I bring you to L.A. now, and the first thing I'd do is go on Burbank Boulevard,
yeah,
take you by Denny's in Lancashire, and then go fucking that direction.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And you see all those old buildings. And
like by your old studio.
Yeah, like you're like, yes, yeah. By the old. That's no. Not that part of Lancashire.
Right.
I'm talking the other east. Side of Burbank Boulevard, east. Oh. Don't make a left there. Go east.
Right.
That place looks like it's 1954.
Yeah.
From there, straight to Victory Boulevard.
Right.
It looks like 1954.
And guys, I still think this, and it's probably just because of the desert, but it looks dirty. Like, especially like, oh, yeah, West LA.
Oh,
it
looks fuck filthy. Yeah.
Filthy.
It is filthy.
It isn't. Filthy.
It's airplane fucking exhaust and car exhaust and human dirt and everything out there, man. Nothing's been sprayed down.
Do you remember the first time someone explained to you what the smog was and showed you? I do. It was fucking gross. Like, it's still gross when you notice it sometimes.
First time I saw it was on a plane. You see it when you land on LAX.
Yeah.
5 out of 10 times. If you land on the right day,
yeah.
You're like, Jesus Christ. And you know what? Then you look straight ahead and you say, I'm going to die. And you accept it for what the fuck it is.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
it. That's the truth. Doesn't matter. Listen, any metropolitan city you go to, you're inhaling something bad.
100%.
I went down to the ocean the other day. Jump in the ocean, come out, go back to the room and smell your arm. You know what you smell like? You smell like 2,000 years of piss, sperm, dead bodies,
diarrhea.
Oil. Diarrhea. God knows what's in that fucking ocean.
Old Taco Bell.
I fucking get in that thing. I boiled myself in that fucking shower.
Fuck,
I took that kid, I boiled her. I took the sand out of it. I still got a rash on my foot. You know, the fucking beaches.
There's no
syringes out there.
You don't know what you're doing no more. Look at this cum jing.
Oh, my God.
He's sending missiles into the fucking Pacific Ocean.
Yeah.
How long till that missile juice comes floating into the Pacific? And, you know, you go eat sushi, and that's what you're eating.
Oh, the old nuclear stuff from the Japan meltdown. Right now.
Nothing that you're eating is fucking safe anymore.
Nope, nothing.
I don't care if you're growing it at your house. Somewhere along the line, there's some form, whether it's old dirt.
Yeah.
It's fucking a nightmare.
Yeah.
It
water.
It really fucking is.
Water.
Yeah, and this bottled water that they've made billions.
Oh.
There's 3 fat Jews somewhere in Israel.
Yeah.
Doing high fives right now. Surrounded with fucking $50 bills going. Yeah. They believe they want this.
Same guys that sold those fake Eclipse glasses. Their eyes are fried.
Hilarious.
These are real. You just put them on like, I'm working at the Sun. These, I bought them on the street corner. These are all right. Your fucking eyes are gone. Oh.
We live in a strange fucking world now, man.
Yeah, right. It
really fucking is a strange world. But you know what, man?
Still good.
I
watched
Dean Del Rizzi, and like I said, you know, I think about 10 years ago, I made a constant decision to tell people to go fuck themselves when they would call me on the phone.
Yeah.
And all they would do was bitch.
Oh, fuck.
I had a bunch of people in my life that every fucking week I had to put them together because this game wasn't fair to them. And why it was fair to them, and I got movies and it wasn't fair to me. And one day I just started telling these people to go fuck themselves.
Yeah.
And you know what? The word got out. Don't even bother him with that topic because he's not going to fucking do nothing. And nobody bothers me no more.
Yeah.
And from time to time, I bump into different comedians that they have no idea what they have going on, so they bitch. They have no idea that I'd rather have them have a journey. They got a TV show at ABC when they don't know what they're doing. They lose that show now. You float around for a while, and then you're like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
You know, everything comes at the right fucking time. You're one of those guys that's just relentless.
Yeah.
And, you know, I tip my hat to you type of guys. You know, I hear you on any trunk. You're all over the place. You're doing spots at the Stand. You know, you jump on a fucking plane to do spots.
Yeah.
I have people that won't fucking get in the car to do a spot. And we'll call you, Lee, and tell you everything that's wrong with life. But this guy's driving down to LAX, sitting in row 22D next to three escape cons from fucking Detroit that are handcuffed next to a fucking marshal. He'll take his hat, he'll put his little iPad on, he'll go to sleep. 3 days he'll crash on his friend's house, 2 days he'll Airbnb. One night he won't get a hotel till 11:15 because that's when the $800 hotel drops to $2,850. He's got till 12 o'clock and then he gets a free buffet. Dean Del Rizzi finds a way, you know what I'm saying? And I tip my hat off to him because if I was single now without a child, I'd be banging it out with you.
Yeah, yeah.
You'd be
That'd
safe.
Be awesome. You
you'd
and
be
I.
Say,
there.
Fuck you, Joey. I'm out 9 weeks. Well, fuck you. I'm staying out an extra week, bitch.
Yeah, yeah.
It's wintertime. I'm sleeping in a shelter. I'm paying my dues, motherfucker.
You know, like I'm always super positive. And then finally, a couple weeks ago, I just snapped. This guy was just like talking shit like, yeah, man, I mean, you know, fucking it's hard, man. You know, you got to fucking me. And I was like, dude, you're 26. I'm 51. I got diabetes, evicted from my apartment, and ran over on my motorcycle. I'll fucking tell you hard, dude. Try doing it at 51 with fucking broke ribs and no apartment. You know what I mean? Like, what? I'm out of an apartment. You know what I'm saying? That's fucking hard. At 26, I'll eat dirt, whatever. You know what I mean? It's just whatever. It's fucking crazy. People just want shit for free, you know?
Or they don't want to do the work.
Nope.
And I knew when I got here that I was not worthy of walking these streets. Mitchie, you go to the comedy store sometime and go, who fucking passed this fucking lunatic? And people go, I don't know. Mitchie must have been on pills. I was one of those guys. Like, I was one of those guys that I caught her off guard. And she started giving me spots, and people were asking, like, why did he get spots, though?
Yeah.
He's fucking R-rated. He's fucking fat. He's up there sweating up a storm. You could smell the coke coming out of his pores and shit.
Yeah.
But I just kept showing up down there.
That's it.
When I got here, I was long in the teeth, man.
Yeah. Yeah, me too. 44.
I was long in the fucking tooth.
Yeah, right.
I mean, my manager would get people to come see me, and they'd go, what are you fucking crazy? He's 150 fucking years old.
Yeah, yeah. I always say, if you want to get a Comedy Central deal, just be on a showcase with me, because I'll murder, and they'll be like, he's 50. And then they'll just grab somebody else that's like 24.
Yeah, I got here when I was 34, and I was already fucking old.
Yeah.
Like, you're already past that fucking WB.
Yeah.
Once you're past the WB, like that age, what's the other one? WB, and there's the other one where kids' shows are on.
Oh, Nickelodeon.
No.
Oh.
Before
Disney?
No. Same thing as WB, only
TBS?
No. Jesus Christ, guys.
I don't know.
There he is. No, there's another one that has those type of shows. CTS, it's Channel 11.
Channel
in LA. Not Fox. It's Fox, but it's a different one. It doesn't matter.
Right.
Once you're past that Buffy group at the time,
yeah,
you were dead. And they told you to your face, like, that's you it. Were dead. Like, it's never going to happen to you. And then I'm like, wait a second. Who the fuck are you kidding? Tool Time was 1,000 years old, and so was the fat dude from with glasses from Ohio.
Yeah,
from Cleveland. These motherfuckers were all fucking long.
Tim Allen and Drew Carey. Yeah, everyone listening along. They were
all fucking long in the
tool. All the guys I loved. Yeah. Were
what the
like,
fuck you know, are you talking about?
CK.
Yeah, and comedy's universal. Yeah, comedy's like, no age limit. If you can talk and you can think and you have emotion and yeah. you have an opinion and you can put them all together and make logic, fucking comedy never goes away.
DeLea and I were just talking about it last night. Like, he was like, dude, you've gotten somewhere in like 7.5 years, and it's mostly because this world we live in now, podcasting and YouTube and Instagram and all that, you can make your own world.
Lee Syatt, how many people in the last 2 years did you have as clients that you sat with them, broke it down for them, and after 3 weeks they didn't do it at all, or they fell apart at the seams?
The majority of them. I mean,
we've had conversations.
The majority of people, not even clients, I had to talk to.
The best compliment I ever got was from Lee. He goes, I haven't even told Paula. Joey Diaz is fucking crazy. I think he's crazy, but Jesus Christ, he's there. We're here. This is what we do. I don't know nothing else to do.
Yeah.
I see you tweeting. I see you, you know, Paul, the great Paul Mooney once said to entertain, you have to be entertained. So like 2 or 3 nights a week, you go to fucking shows.
Yeah.
You know, that's very important.
Yep.
You know, I smoke pot and zone out on YouTube on all live performances.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I sit there and watch Rainbow with the one singer.
Yeah.
You know, YouTube has rare fucking shit.
Love it.
And then I go through cycles all year long. I go through different cycles. I go from Leonard Skinner to Eric Clapton to Zepp, like now I'm back. I haven't been on Zepp in about a year.
Oh, I'm back there too.
No, I have not been there.
Oh, yeah.
I have not been there. Ooh. I got into the Bon Scott thing for about 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Just Bon Scott, all the videos by Bon Scott. Poor bastard. He couldn't even lip sync. He was so bad.
No, I think he just didn't want to.
Yeah.
You know, he's like, fuck this. I'm the real deal. Lines. Yeah.
He was
like, I'm the real deal.
You could tell he was 10 years old than everybody.
Yeah, it's crazy.
And just fucking lit.
There's a guy long in the tooth, man.
Long
fucking
in the tooth.
Fucking made it.
Around young fucking kids. It's funny. I was listening to Eddie Trunk and that crew the other day, and they were talking about some interesting shit that. Eventually, you know, Guns N' Roses, who was the most popular band on the road.
Yeah, yep, most money this year.
Most money this year. I guess they'll stop touring. Like, this is it. This is the last leg. Like, they're going back to New York in November.
Yeah, they're doing the fucking Forum 6 nights. Yeah.
So now, they're going to finish, and then Axl's going to go on tour with AC/DC.
Well, that's the rumor. We'll see. You know what I mean? Nobody knows what AC/DC is going to do right now. That's the rumor. But did you see Brian Johnson sang with the Muse last week?
No.
Yeah. So, and Eddie Trunk and I were talking about, we feel like he was playing his card without saying AC/DC fired me. You know, they're like, well, his hearing's out. He can't do it. And he was like, basically went out and sang with this band, the Muse. He did Back in Black, and it killed. And that's his way of saying, nah, man. Without saying it, he's like, I'm fine. I'm over here. So now it's put a ripple, I think, in the AC/DC camp, because he didn't go away quiet, you know? He sang Back in Black, killed it. Fucking Europe last week.
I got to be honest with you.
Yeah.
Like I said, once I heard For Those Who Are About to Rock.
Yeah, yeah.
That was when I put the AC/DC casket down. I could lie to you and tell you.
Yeah.
I think years later, I like Thunderstruck.
Yeah.
And they put it in the longest yard, but I was done with AC/DC. I hear something off Highway to Hell. I hear something off Power Rage or something.
Oh, yeah.
It brings a tear to my eye. I can't lie to anybody. But you really got me watching him again.
Yeah.
And I finally made the conclusion. I told you on one of the podcasts, I finally made the conclusion that I did not like him. And I thought about it.
Yeah.
I think he was great. And he sold me in 81.
Right.
In 80 and 81, both of those times, he sold me. You know, Back in Black today is almost as popular as it was when it was released.
It's crazy. It's like it's Thriller and that. But Back in Black and Thriller.
I hear, pour a drink on me.
Yeah, yeah. Have a drink on me.
I hear Back in Black.
Yep.
And Hell's Bells twice a week.
Shook me all night
every
long.
Every fucking week on Sirius stations.
Shook whether me all night
whether
long.
Whether it's fucking Ozzy's Boneyard or Hand Nation, I hear both of those fucking songs. But it's popular. Now, you have to go back to summer of 80.
Yeah.
When they released that. Every party you go to, that album was on. And it went on till fucking something else got popular. And then that was a year later, you know. So I remember when that album came out, I couldn't wait for it to go away.
Yeah.
Like, I just couldn't wait. It was like I was growing up in like an argument camp. Like, it was Van Halen now. Then once AC/DC came back, fuck you, Van Halen.
Yeah.
Van Halen came out with Van Halen, too.
It was a bounce back and forth.
It was a bouncer that was back and forth that people don't understand. I had the great Eddie Bravo once in a green room, and he was telling me how his neighborhood struggle was all the bands against him and his brother for having Kiss albums.
Oh, yeah.
So whenever Kiss came out with a new album, he would have to sneak it into the neighborhood under his shirt, you know, and go home and throw it under his bed like he was a communist.
Yeah.
Then later on, when all the kids went inside, he would put it on in his room with earphones on, you know, shit like that.
Love gun.
The shit that we do for the love of our music.
It's crazy. I'll tell you what, Joey. To me, and this is me, you don't like Brian Johnson, and
I just was. He sold me, the bill of lading at the time.
Right.
And now, after 30 years, I have the right to say that I miss Bon Scott.
Yeah, absolutely. I do, too. Okay, I got it tattooed on my side. Yeah.
That's what I meant to say.
But fuck, man. I look at it as if Brian Johnson, AC/DC was a band that, and Bon Scott never existed. Just these three records, Back in Black, Those About to Rock, and Flick of the Switch. I'm hooked on these records again, man. And
how was Flick of the Switch?
That fucking record is fire, man. I gave it to Maron, and I go, this record is underrated. It would be any other band's best record of all time.
I'll listen to it.
Oh, man. It's
listen, I put on some Brian Johnson shit.
Yeah.
Then I got to tell you something. The performances they were doing were fucking brilliant.
Killer.
I mean, you turned me onto one somewhere.
Yeah, oh, Japan.
Somewhere.
That Japan.
And then I went on like a 6-video run of them in ginormous venues.
Like
I'm talking
Germany.
About arenas.
Yeah.
And their light show, the timing, the way the lights hit Angus, the way he would move around, it's brilliant.
Yeah.
The power, and I can't deny that. His power with his voice to carry in that arena at that fucking age.
Yeah.
You know, that's something I just. I was so much Angus, Bon Scott, Highway to Hell was just a fucking.
It's a masterpiece.
To me, till this day, when I'm having a fucked up day and I gotta write something, I'll go home, put the earphones on. I'm going to back, get stoned to the gills.
Yeah.
I'll put the fucking earphones on, G, and I'll start that album from scratch. I can't lie to you. I fast forward Highway to Hell. I'm too old.
Yeah, me too.
I'm too old for Highway to Hell.
Yep.
Girls Got Rhythm. Sometimes I'm in the mood. Sometimes I'm not.
Right.
But I started with Walk All Over You.
Shut Down in Flames.
By the time No. Then that jam after fucking.
Beating Around the Bush.
No. One of those nights. She's got the touch. Touch
Too Much.
By the time Touch Too Much comes on, you're ready to stab a motherfucker.
Yeah.
Then you listen to Shot Down in Flames.
Incredible.
And then the last jam is Night Prowler.
Unbelievable.
So listen to your state of mind.
Yeah.
Now, here's what gets even more fucked up. And I'm sorry to sound like one of those dudes at Subway Sandwiches that you walk in with the ponytail.
Yeah.
And the Led Zeppelin t-shirt. And he's like, hey, man, I went to see Pink Floyd, man. And the other three sandwich makers are like, ooh.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, I hate that fucking dude.
Yeah.
That was what I dreaded being.
Yeah.
Was one of those dudes, Dean Delray.
Yeah.
That you were like that cool old man, you know. What are we talking about?
Much.
Who?
Well, I'm sure you had any. Well, the concerts.
Yeah, but I was going to tell you, I saw them at Madison Square Garden, which I don't have to tell you.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I still remember making plans. Mm-hmm. I had the album, and all of a sudden somebody goes, you know, fucking AC/DC's playing the Garden with Ted Nugent on Saturday. And I'm like, come on.
Yeah.
At that time, my mom wouldn't come home till about 6 at night. So at 2, 3 o'clock, I'd go home. I'd take a little hit of a joint. I'd hide the joint, and I'd go upstairs. And there was 3 albums on my Victrola. You ready?
Yeah.
Ted Weekend Warriors.
Oh, yeah.
AC/DC Power Rage.
Yeah.
Highway to Hell. But the sleeper was Hotel California.
Oh,
and
love
I'd
that
play
record.
All 4 of them every fucking afternoon, loud and lip sync, and play the air guitar like a half a fag. But guess what? It kept my powder dry. You know what I'm saying?
Fuck yeah, dude.
That was so fucking good to listen to that shit.
Hotel California, dude. It's everything about it. The cover, the guitar playing, the lyrics, the songs. Life in the Fast Lane. I remember when that came out, I kept thinking was one day I'm going to get a Camaro and I'll have that fucking 8-track player, you know, like playing Life in the Fast Lane. I'll be driving to school. I'll be 18 or whatever, you know. It's just, you know, that thing is smoking. That band is unbelievable. Unbelievable.
You know, I'm like the rest of the world. I saw them I never saw them live until I saw the video of them doing Hotel California. I was a kid when that song came out.
Yeah, yeah.
I still remember when that whole song, I still remember when One of These Nights came out.
Yeah.
That's how old I am.
Yeah, yeah.
I was in the 6th grade slinging dick. I had 2 girlfriends in Miami.
Yeah.
Natasha and Rebecca. And that song was the song of the summer. And I got to tell you something, till this fucking day, that is one of, that's got to be in my top 10 songs. That song, another fucking jam that gets my heart riled up.
Killer.
Oh, my God. So I was way into them. When Hotel California came out, I was a kid. I liked Hotel California. I liked Life in the Fast Lane. There was one other jam on there that was tremendous. And then the last one is a great album. The one with the
Long Run?
I can't tell you now yet.
I love that record. Underrated.
Brilliant. That came out in 1980.
Killer.
And they just said, it's over.
Yeah.
Lights out in Georgia like fucking UFO. And then something happened. I moved to Aspen. I was house sitting in Snowman's Village, all right? And here's this fucking Cuban spick with felonies on the horizon.
Yeah.
Which one, pick 'em?
Yeah.
And I'm living in this fucking house. But the dude told me that I could live over the garage, not to drive his car, and never, ever, ever, ever go in his house unless it's to get the shovels or to check the jacuzzi levels or shit like that. I wasn't allowed to do laundry in this house. Nothing.
Yeah.
Even though he had a state-of-the-art laundry room.
Uh-huh.
Press button, 1985. Suck my dick, pal. You live in Northern California. You're one of the partners in TGIFs.
Oh, wow.
He was loaded. He had houses all over the country. And he had 4 kids. And, you know, he told me, he goes, we're going to come 2 weeks out of the year.
Wow.
Okay. But he never came 2 weeks out of the year. He would send his daughter once a year with 4 of her college friends. They would order up $500 worth of booze, drink one night, puke, and leave all the bottles out for Uncle Joey to have parties with his bitches.
Like a soldier.
Dog, I was living up in the fucking main bedroom.
Oh, fuck, yeah, he's never there.
No, I had the jacuzzi, the steam room. I had a living room the size of this fucking building, Lee, that overlooked the mountains. It was ski in and ski out. If you were above a certain point, you could just ski out, and the guards wouldn't say nothing to you. Go ahead. I would have, like, an old ski ticket on there. Yeah, vote for me.
Vote for me.
Oh, tremendous. You have no fucking idea.
Vote for me.
Dean Del Rizzi. Living like a doctor. Nobody. Yeah. I didn't even believe it. I'm like, I'm a fucking kid that's a fucking criminal.
Yeah.
And I'm house sitting this motherfucker.
TGIF owner.
In 86, I got into fucking snorting.
Yeah.
And all you need is, you don't know what life is till you snort coke in a mansion by yourself. You hear and see all type of things when you're up after a day.
Oh, yeah.
I used to fucking hide in closets and in the steam room, and I had coke hidden all over the house, and then my girlfriend moved in, and we'd see things in the backyard. It was horrible.
Oh.
So at night, it was called 475 Faraway Road.
Yeah.
That was the address.
Wow.
Snowmass Village. Type it up, Lee. It's for sale still.
I think we should. We found it, right?
Yeah? It's for sale?
It's for sale. So I would sing that lyrics in some. There was one part where he would say something, and it was my Hotel California.
Wow.
In my mind, it was my own personal Hotel California.
Aspen or what was it?
Yeah, no, Snowmass Village. You could check out anytime you like, but you can never leave. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I had people up there for days up in that motherfucker.
I love that photo is the Beverly Hills Hotel.
Yeah, I never knew that.
Fuck, I didn't either, man, until they broke it down. But the guy that shot that was telling stories about it. Perfect sun behind it, took the picture, man. And then the Beverly Hills Hotel wanted it off there, you know? And they're like, nah, we didn't use your name or anything. You know what I mean? It's wild. I love that cover. And then the back part where they're just in that lobby, it's so spooky, you know? That record kills. Imagine just having a perfect fucking record, you know?
It takes a lot of work. See, what do they want for how much? 17? No.
4.7.
4.7. Wow. You see those two garages?
Yeah.
That was supposed to be my apartment on top of those two garages.
Oh, I would have taken just that as a palace.
No, but it wasn't like that then. Yeah. There wasn't even a window on that side. There was just a door. You walked in up those steps on the side, but you can't see with the tree.
Look at that, Jerry. Just your cocaine palace.
That was my cocaine palace. The other side with the chimney?
Yeah.
Up on the second floor?
Yeah,
the
left there, yeah.
That was the Uncle Joey. Suck your asshole room.
Yeah.
You can never come in, but you can never go out.
5,000 square feet, 7 bedrooms, 7 bath. Look at that,
dude. It had 2 bedrooms downstairs.
Yeah.
It had a study, and another bedroom upstairs, like a master bedroom. And then it had 2 bedrooms down on the level where the kitchen was.
Wow.
And the living room.
Yeah, look at that.
Pretty nice fucking house, man. I lucked out.
Wow. How'd you land that? You just meet the guy somewhere?
No. My buddy landed the job.
Uh-huh.
And I was in San Francisco, and I had to leave San Francisco because the cops were on to me. So I went to Boulder. I'm in Boulder minding my business, and I just called him to check in with him. He goes, where you at? I go, I'm in Boulder. He goes, listen, brother, I got a little situation. I knocked up my wife, my girlfriend, and we don't want to raise a kid here. We got the fuck. I got to get a job in Jersey. When can you get up here? And I go, I could be up there next week.
Yeah.
So I already had connections from when I lived there before. I made some calls. I moved in with him. I moved in with him for like 2 nights. He showed me everything I had to do. It was basically 20 hours a week.
Wow.
No, I'm lying to you guys. It was like 10 hours a week.
Yeah.
So basically, in the wintertime, you shovel snow.
Yeah.
In the summer, you fucking cut the grass.
Your own shining up there.
That was it. No, you had neighbors.
Yeah, neighbors.
And then he gave you projects every year.
Oh, wow.
And he didn't pay you for the labor.
Yeah, but you got
the paid for the materials. Yeah. So he would go, Joey, paint the southern wall over there the color that I'm going to send you to this hardware store. And I would paint it, and then he would pay me for the materials. But he would never fucking pay me for the labor.
Yeah.
But I was like, fuck him. Yeah. I disconnected the speedometer in his car.
Oh,
I was living like a doctor with a brand new cheap fucking Ranger.
Yeah.
It was just insane. It really was insanity. It was the Hotel California.
You can disconnect that stuff?
Oh, yeah, man. They had the cable back then. Now it's all digital. You can't. But back then it was a cable. Right behind the dash.
But once you put it back, they could always tell.
Yeah.
It was untraceable because the numbers wouldn't add up.
Yeah.
The numbers would go off like when you're in Las Vegas. They would stagger. So
but by that point, you'd be long gone?
By that point, you put the fucking cable on. They don't know. One day they took it to the fucking, they take it to sell it.
Yeah.
And the people come back and go, you disconnected the cable. What are you talking about?
Look
at the speedometer. It's all fucked up. What the fuck you think you're dealing with, asshole? And then they find you. And by that time, I'm long gone.
Long gone.
Where's Tony Bennett, cocksucker? tasted like the chef of the future? No.
No.
But I think about this shit, yeah. And I go, you know what? It's all good.
I never think about
it's all fucking good. Look at the shit you eat in real life, Lee.
Yeah, Lee eats it like Burger King.
He ate a Korean sandwich 2 weeks ago right off the street. Walked into a place.
Right up the street.
For some reason, yeah. Just
that guy didn't even wipe his ass with toilet paper.
20,000 fucking restaurants. He walks down the street happily.
Yeah.
And instead of going to the safe option, no, I'm going to get a Korean fucking sandwich. I couldn't believe this one. This one's the one that really fucking
I love Lee. Every time I'm here, you get the food story on. Last time it was the sushi boats.
Oh, please. There's always something else. It never ends. It's never ending. I had a fucking.
But I don't want to eat shit, and then that's weird. That's
terrible. He complained. He gagged.
Yeah. I'm ready to take
it. Seen him.
I'm going to go out to the desert.
30 right? fucking years. I never saw nobody even mention shit.
Never.
This is how bad he is. This is how bad it is. So, the best. One of the. I hate to say this, but we're comedians. And, you know, sometimes you. Whatever you wish for might come true, but. Look what happened in Burning Man. The guy lit himself on fire.
I know, man.
They say he was straight. Yeah, good, right. Yeah. Keep believing that.
Yeah, yeah, fuck you. He was not straight.
That dog did that. They told him only do a half of this.
Yeah.
And they meant it. He didn't take him serious.
No.
He did three of them.
Yeah.
He went down and he saw that fire and he goes, fuck it. This will save my life. It's kind of cold out here anyway.
He's like, I'm the Burning Man.
Oh, my God.
I couldn't believe it. And they said that.
Have you been?
Nope. It's the probably one of the only things I've ever done. But
why not?
You know, because every time.
I mean, you're an outgoing guy. I'm a sack of shit.
Every time I heard about it, it was always like, you know, like fucking, oh man, there was fucking windstorms and sand and, well, we couldn't fucking see. Like, I never heard a good story of, like, it was beautiful and perfect. It was always like, you know, sandstorms and no bathroom and, you know, whatever. It's fucking 70,000 people.
Do you camp?
I don't camp, but I would on that, you know.
Is that what people do? No, I'm asking. Yeah, camping.
They got camping and people sleep in cars and, you know, campers and all that shit. And it's just like a fucking just miles of like salt flat kind of style area, you know.
There was only one festival I felt bad about not going. And that was the Yes Festival.
Oh, yeah.
Because I was this close.
Yeah, I was there.
And I liked every band that was performing there. And after that, I just...
Yeah.
I remember going to Phyllis Green and watching Don Henley, and I noticed how the concert scene had changed. I noticed that now the smell of marijuana was offending people.
Yeah.
And then I went to a Grateful Dead concert at Red Rocks, and it was just off the chains.
Fuck yeah.
It really was off the chains.
That's the shit right there.
And then I went to, like, there were just a couple concerts. It was like hit and miss at that age.
Yeah.
Like, I was explaining to Lee that I was getting to places and going, why the fuck am I here? Like, I remember going to see Aerosmith at the Soap Factory.
Yeah.
And they were so bad. But before they even started playing, like, when they walked out, I'll never forget looking at them going, why am I here?
Yeah.
This isn't Aerosmith. And they started playing, and he was horrid. And I was furious, you know?
Yeah.
I've said it before. I walked out of Twisted Sister.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, I used to ask myself.
I was going
to
see you back then all mad. Fuck these guys.
No, I wouldn't even say that.
Oh, yeah, you just leave?
I just look at you and go, psst, we're either in or you're out. You want to stay? What do you mean? I'm having a good time.
Uh-huh.
Listen, we're leaving. You know, it's a 40 minute fucking
drive. Find your own way home.
Yes, you gotta make a choice. You want to stay for this shit or you want to come? And you leave because it's $50 to get home.
Fuck yeah.
And you only got 62 for the weekend. You know what I'm saying?
Man. So, I never left, man. I always go straight to the front and got ready for the ride. I was short, so I'd be like, excuse me, I can't see. I'd play that card. And I'd get, oh, let him by, man, let him by. You know, I'd get right up to the fucking rail, dead center, front row, every show. And I always come out with a pick. I'd look down the ground, find a 10 or a 20, you know, some ground scores, somebody's wallet they dropped.
I had a couple of picks. I went to Glenn Tipton.
Yeah, right, so. Oh, fuck yeah.
I had a couple of picks.
I still got mine, Joey, in a box.
Oh, Jesus Christ, I lost all.
Oh, I take pictures of them, put them on Instagram.
I was just writing about this fucking... I scored when I was a kid, Dean Del Rizzi. I always scored. I was a good album thief.
Yeah.
Not only was I a good drug thief, and I knew how to burn, but I knew how to rob an album. There was a place on Burgerland Avenue that I knew if I bought one album, I got one free. It was my own deal.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I walked two up to the counter, but I only paid for one. I would take the bag, and on the way down, I'd pick the other one and walk up with the bag facing him. The inside thumb would be holding the album, and I'd walk out and put it in the bag like I owned the joint. Bang.
Yeah, two for one.
I did the same thing at Crazy Eddie's or whatever the fuck, those album stores in Jersey.
Your own Columbia house.
Oh, yeah. But the easiest score I ever had was Pathmark. Pathmark's score was pretty fucking easy. Pathmark was a supermarket on the East Coast. And they were always there when I was growing up on like 78th and Tunley Avenue. And at that time, I'm 82, I got busted in there shoplifting. I tried to rob a gas station, Georgie Amico, and I went down there to rob a gun. And I got busted clipping a toy gun.
Oh,
so man. I stayed out of there for like 6 months, and then I started going back down, and they had opened up. They always had a magazine section.
Yeah.
That's not a fart, that's the chair. They opened up a magazine section, but next to the magazines, they put record albums. And I'm not talking about Sinatra, I'm talking about this. Like what was going on right now. Yeah, they wanted to get into the music business.
Yeah.
So they had everything by The Who, everything by Led Zeppelin. So it was like starting from scratch. I would go in there every day around 4 o'clock. And I would take the albums I wanted, 3-4 of them, and I would stack them real close to the magazines.
Yeah.
Because the fence would close, and I could still pick them up and carry them through the fence.
Yeah.
You can't write this shit.
Nope.
I did this, and I would go either put them on the bottom of the shopping cart and buy groceries, pay for the groceries, and then I'd walk out the store with them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
On the bottom of the thing with 3 or 4 albums. I did this 4 times a week. I had a fucking huge box with a long stack of albums.
Fresh vinyl.
Fresh vinyl. Fresh vinyl. They covered it. And what they didn't have, like I was always getting albums on the sly. I look at all this thing and I'm like, how many times did I buy each of this fucking thing? Sabbath, yeah. Bloody Sabbath.
Yeah.
I gave Sharon Osbourne's father fucking money 10 times. Because they don't see a dime from this shit, those poor bastards.
Yeah, I know, man. Those fucking robbers.
Who'd you go see when you were in New York this last time?
Greta Van Fleet. Incredible. 19-year-olds. Dude, fire it up. Fire it up for Joey. You gotta hear it, man. Two guys, twins, they're 20.
Now, you've seen them a couple of times.
Yep. I went and saw them at the Viper Room last month. They played 6 songs, and then Florentine and I went and saw them in New York 2 weeks ago, and they played an hour. They're from Detroit, and it's two brothers, or it's three brothers and a friend. Two of the guys are twins, and the other guy's a younger guy, and they're like Zeppelin meets Heart, and the fucking Greta Van Fleet. And they're kids, Joey, and they murder. They murder it live, man. You're gonna love it, man. It's like, it's pure kids playing rock and roll right there, Highway Tune. Right there. Oh, what the fuck?
No, here you go. Here you go. Those people.
Here you go. This is great, man. These guys are kids, and they're fucking out there. They're selling out everywhere, man. People are loving it. Rock and roll.
This is very interesting to a guy like me.
Yeah.
I mean, if you close your eyes for a minute there, it's Robert Plant and Jimmy Page.
Right?
You know, if you close your eyes and you go, okay, what makes these fucking, how old can they be? 21?
20 and 17.
Okay, so what makes these 20-year-olds play this type of music when they get jumped up and out, jump up and down with a fucking DJ?
Yeah.
And fucking whatever the fuck they do. You listen to this and it moves you, because especially older guys like you and I, because we know where they got this from.
Yep.
They got this from their dad, who said, fuck you, listen to this shit.
That's what happened.
And three kids listen to this shit.
Yep.
They took a friend, they go, no, listen to the idea we got. This, that sounded like a little bit of the Immigrant Song.
Yeah. I want to play one more for you, Jim. Okay, so go to the EP and play Black Smoke Rising right there, that song. Check this out, dude. And they fucking play live, and they sing live, and they play the shit out of this stuff, man. And we were in, Florentine and I were just going, this is fucking great, man. And people are into it. It's so selling out everywhere. And I had him on the podcast. And you did. Yeah, I had him at the Comedy Store. We did it live there, all four of them, and it was fucking great. I turned Eddie Trunk onto him. He's playing him. I turned Nikki Sixx onto him. He's playing him. And they're getting out there. So check this one out. This one's smoking.
It's Jimmy Page.
Yeah.
So much. And somebody else is in there.
It sounds like Hart right there, the singing.
Yeah.
You know, singing. Like Barracuda, a little bit of vibe, you know?
I love when I see shit like this. People right? Who've taken something and said, you know what? We grew up listening to this. Our dad forced us on this. Our mom listened to this. And then we went to guitar school. Where the fuck you go and learn how to play all this shit? And you're like, I listened to something recently that. You want to fucking slit your wrist because you didn't join a band and do this type of shit.
Right.
What the fuck was it? I thought of you too, but you were in New York. I didn't call you. Late night, I got home from the comedy
store. You call me anytime, dude. I love when you call me.
You know, you get home from the comedy store some nights, and there's some nights that you think of a joke you said, Lee reminds me of something on the way home. So you sit down, you open up your computer, you put YouTube on, and you write whatever you remember in the sequence the best that you can.
Yeah.
But while you're fucking around on YouTube, if you sign in, it plays all the shit that you've played in over the years. So
right.
Something came on, I scrolled, and I looked at it, and I go, oh my God, and I put it on, and I thought about you. What the fuck was it? Was it UFO? Now, there's something I do want to get involved with you in.
Oh, yeah.
Word on the street is March 19th. I don't know if that's the date. Shankner is in San Jose.
Yeah, yeah. I think Orange County, though.
But is he doing Orange County?
Yeah, he's doing Orange County.
What the date is?
The Grove. The place called The Grove. Yeah, look it up, Shankner. Dude, we have to go to that.
That'll be my last hurrah with shows.
I think so.
You gotta smoke reefer, though.
Oh, I'm all over.
Right, I don't want no misunderstanding.
No, fuck.
No stars, no nothing.
No, I'm thinking maybe a little, a cap. Take a little cap.
No worries.
Get in there. No worries. No worries.
Yeah, whatever. I'm yeah. Put the fear of God in you.
I think we need to do that, though, and go see Shankner.
I watched some of his shit from like 3 years ago.
Unbelievable.
And he's still fucking tremendous, you know. Yeah. I don't know if he's drinking.
Yeah.
I don't really give a fuck. Is he? Is he going to show up to the shows? He might, you know, people say he stopped showing up.
Yeah, he'll be there.
Michael Schenker, Schenker.
I'm glad you got to check out Greta Van Fleet. Fucking cool, man.
Yeah, they were playing Michael Schenker himself.
Yeah, here we go.
You bad motherfucker.
So, tour right there.
Look at this shit.
Yeah, he looks great.
I don't know if he's updated.
Yeah, here we go. So it is, go down a little more, it's in March there. So there it is right there. Looking for some California date, keep going. There it is, right, Anaheim, right there, March 25th, City National Grove. Let's go to that, 100%.
Who's
playing? I don't think tickets are available yet, maybe not.
Is the whole
now, I heard he's got all three singers. He's got Graham Bonnet, I think, Macaulay, and the third singer. I guess he's going out with three singers.
Now, who was the first singer from MSG? Are you hot tonight?
Yeah.
And was he also the singer on?
His name, Gary Barden.
Was that who it was?
And then you got Graham Bonnet on the second one.
No, it was the same singer as the first one.
Or the third one or whatever. Attack of the Mad Axe Man, Graham Bonnet. And then you get Macaulay. Yeah, let's go to Wikipedia real quick.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Gary Barden.
Okay, on the first album. Let me see who was on the first and the second album.
Yeah,
let's
go Michael Schenker Group.
This is interesting shit right now.
Yeah,
see?
Yeah.
I'm getting old. My memory is slipping, man.
Yeah, yeah. Mine's starting to come back after the
No Sugar.
Yeah, No Sugar.
My mind is TikTok Magoo. You know, okay. I stay on top of that shit.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so go down, slide down. And then find that's a record. So okay, over here where the chronological records are, on the right there. Yeah. Okay. So we want to hit Michael MSG. Now let's see. Go down. No, not that one. The other one. Go back. Right there, Michael Schenker. That one. Okay. So let's look at the records real quick. And the first one. I'm almost 100%. It's Gary Barden. So, where's the records? Discovery. Okay, right there. 80. Michael Schenker Group. 80. Right there. Yeah, there you go. Singer. Let's see. Go down to a singer. Look at that. Roger Glover fucking produced that. There it is. Gary Barden. I knew it.
All right, now, who was the band for the second album?
And then the second...
For MSG.
Yeah, go to the second record. I'm almost sure that it's... there you go. Singer is... Gary Barden. Then the third one is Graham Bonnet. Let's check the third one. Look at that Cozy Pal on drums. What a god, he's gone now. Not that one, sorry. Assault Attack.
Who was on One Night of Budokan?
Well, that's a live record.
That's a live. I had that.
I believe it's Gary Barden singing from the tours there. Let's see. Look. Yep.
Yeah, Gary Barden.
Yeah. So then go to the next.
Cozy Powell was on that tour.
Yeah. I saw Jesus that tour, Christ. Dude. I saw the first record tour at Wolfgang's in San Francisco.
Look, he did Doctor Doctor, but it's for Phil Mogg.
Yeah,
that's who he wrote it with.
Yeah, that's who he wrote it. So then go to the Attack.
That was a great show if you watched Assault them do Attack. All those songs.
It's great, right?
That's crazy.
Here we go. This is definitely Graham Bonnet. I'm almost 100% sure. There it is, Graham Bonnet. Yep. I saw all the eras, so I remember.
Yeah, by this time I was gone.
Yeah, the once first two that, are masterpieces.
Masterpieces.
They're unbelievable.
I had them. I still listen to On and On once a month.
Oh, fuck.
I still listen on the planes.
Yeah.
I have both albums on my iPod.
Yeah.
So I'll listen to fucking both albums from on those six-hour flights.
Yeah.
A couple stars, maybe a pot cookie, and Uncle Joey's fucking going to the Meteors. You know what I'm saying?
Let me tell you something. You know where Cobbs is?
Yeah.
Well, that was a club called Wolfgang's. Michael Schenker played there on the first record. I was front row. The place held maybe about 405.
Was it the same way?
Same setup, man. And I watched Michael Schenker in there. Absolutely. I got some photos. I snuck a shit camera in. I got them at my house. I'll bring them next time. And I watched him melt the fucking place to the ground. I mean, it was incredible.
And I could sit here and tell you that I knew what the fuck I was doing. I had no idea.
Yeah.
But like in 1978, my mother hadn't died yet. I still went to, I had gone to a few concerts. Not even AC/DC yet.
Yeah.
I was right before AC/DC. And one of the fucking dudes from the neighborhood who sold THC Crystal.
Yeah.
Said he had tickets to go see Rainbow at one of those theaters in Newark, New Jersey, or in one of those bad neighborhoods.
Yeah, yeah. Some Aragon ballroom shit.
Yeah, it was like, I don't even know if it was Rainbow. It was the Scorpions.
Yeah.
And somebody else, but Michael Schenker was there that night.
Wow.
That's the first time I went in there. I could lie to you and I didn't know nothing.
Right.
But all I knew was I left there. And I wanted to know who that guitar player was.
Right.
And about 2 weeks later, he released, no, like, I don't know, maybe a year or two later,
yeah,
he released that fucking album. By that time, I had bought, like, Lights Out.
Yeah.
I had bought
Strangers in the Night, live one?
No. The one with One More for the Rodeo on it.
Right.
Let's see Michael Schenker with UFO. I can't see it all.
Here we go. Just quick UFO. Right there. Okay, so here's the records. Obsession.
That's the one.
Yeah.
That was the one. That blew my fucking mind.
78, Obsession.
Yeah, that one. And then I went backwards. I got Lights Out. And then I got Phenomenon.
Yeah.
And then I got Strangers in the Night.
Yeah.
And then after that, I think I was done. That's when I was done.
Heavy
Pet. That is one of my...
That one's great. Look at the cover.
That is one of my favorite albums of all time.
UFO, Only You Can Rock Me.
Obsession, yes. I was One More for the Rodeo type of guy. Play One More for the Rodeo. Listen to the fucking guitar on this, guys.
Yeah.
Listen to Michael Schenker on this. And now this is 79.
Yeah.
I'm doing acid.
Yeah.
Okay. My friends are into Pink Floyd, Zeppelin. They're into Lynyrd Skynyrd, the Kinks.
Boston.
No. Ted, Heavy Stones, Heavy Doors, Heavy Who. But nobody, unless you were from Uptown. Really, right there, One More for the Rodeo. No, is it One More for the Rodeo? What the fuck is the name of the song we're talking about?
One More for the Rodeo.
Yeah, One More for the Rodeo.
Yeah, right there. Look at that. Three.
Not live. No, not live. That one, 2008 remastered.
Yeah, right there.
Listen to Michael Schenker's guitar, please, ladies and gentlemen. Kick it, Lee.
Look at the cover, dude. So fucking
trippy
cool.
Trippy as fuck.
Love that cover, dude.
guitars. I mean, I put it up there with Page at the Garden, you know, fucking Santana at Woodstock.
Totally.
That guitar right there, he's got like two or three of these live, but we can't play it now. This is when you're home, you get stoned at 2 a.m, look for one more for the rodeo, do it on the studio version, and then watch the two videos live, and watch this fucking blonde 6-foot-something zombie tear this fucking guitar apart.
Dude, I love everything about him.
And nobody knows about him.
No.
Like, the kids today would not know fucking about him.
No.
And you have no idea, because listen, Jimi Hendrix was great.
Yeah.
And you know what? When at the age of 14, 12, 13, when I started getting into this shit, Jimi Hendrix was great, but you know what? Jimmy Page was alive and kicking.
Yeah.
So I went with a dude who was alive. I'll listen to Jimmy later. He ain't making no new music, all right?
Yeah.
I'll catch up on his shit later.
Yeah.
And every once in a while, hey, Joe, and all that shit was cute. But I was always a guitar whore.
Yeah, me
like,
too.
Listen to what I listen to.
Yeah.
I like this. I like Gilmore.
Yeah.
I like fucking Jimmy Page. I love all this fucking guitar.
Montrose. I love Montrose.
I got stoned and put on Bad Company at like 2 a.m. I was on like 2,000 milligrams. Me and Lee went somewhere and we got a bagel or some shit.
Oh.
I went home. I was lit. You know when you're high on THC and you know no matter how high on THC you are, you're not going to be able to fall asleep. Your mind's going to run away.
You might
even have an anxiety attack. So I said, why go to bed? I was going to call him and torture him. Tell him not to answer the phone if the cops call, that type of shit.
Yeah.
And the next thing you know, I said, let me put on YouTube. And fucking, I put on, I went from like, I went from Debbie Gibson. Debbie Gibson was on Sirius.
Oh, yeah.
And she was emceeing her own music.
Deborah Gibson?
And Foolish Beat of My Heart.
Yeah.
So I went home.
I had a crush on her, young.
Please,
boy.
I love that album.
God.
I love that. Fuck, I was snorting coke in the halfway house when that album came out.
I was in love with her.
I don't know if I was in love with her. I just liked that little faggy music.
Yeah, I liked her.
You know who Debbie Gibson is, Lee?
Yeah.
No, I don't know.
Foolish Beat of My Heart.
Oh, yeah.
She's a little Jewish girl from Long Island.
I wanted to date her so bad.
Listen, guys.
Yeah.
She hosted the 30th anniversary of this song. And I got to tell you something. I couldn't get out of the car. It was so interesting.
Yeah.
She was so refreshing. She talked about why Foolish Beat, Debbie Gibson.
Yeah. Later changed it to Deborah Gibson.
Get it together. She's a Goomba. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Hit it right there. Video.
There she Foolish is right Beat. There.
Play the video, Lee. Hit it, Lee. This little Jewish girl from Long Island.
I love the Jewish girls, Joey. Yeah, that's all I like. I
love them. Listen to this shit, Lee.
That's all I like.
Who the fuck plays Debbie Gibson circa 1987
from UFO
on the fucking podcast?
Yeah. From UFO to this. We go all everywhere.
This was my shit, Lee Syatt, 1987. I get coked up and listen to this and jerk off and shit.
Yeah, we got the soft side to us. Right?
I wouldn't look at the video and whack off. I just listen to the song.
Wow.
Keep it, Lee. on expose.
Oh yeah.
Let this. No, what was it? Let this. Put in let this, and the rest will come up. Let me be the one. That's the
expose.
One.
Expose.
Expose was right along with this. This is when I was fucking in a halfway house.
Yeah.
Hanging out with criminals and shit. And I had this jam in the car. This jam was hot.
Oh, man.
Lee, how long would it take you?
Oh, I love that.
Expose.
I love that Rockwell. Somebody's watching me.
Oh, my God. That's awesome.
I always feel like somebody's watching me. Remember that one?
Oh, please. That was Barry Gordy's son.
Yeah, it's
they
great.
Put a gun to Michael. Let the third one.
Here we go.
They put here a gun. Go. They put a gun to Michael Jackson's head and making him sing. Kick it, Lee. Kick that me, Lee.
Oh, yeah. Here we go.
Listen to this shit.
This is great.
These are three fucking dudes, three chicks from Miami.
Yeah. Yep.
This was a great fucking album. Seasons Change. They had three or four hits on it.
Oh, these guys were huge.
Come Go With Me. Yeah, yeah. Here we go, Lee. Kick it.
I love the 80s sound.
I love this shit.
Total Hall & Oates.
I would stay up and watch the videos at night and shit.
Yeah. This, I'd be jamming this stuff.
No, I wouldn't be secretly. People knew I was out in the open. When I went home in 94,
yeah,
I'll tell you who I got hooked on. Janet Jackson.
Oh, fuck yeah. Control record?
In 94, Control, oh. The one after that,
oh,
and
okay.
Then that other one.
With, Pleasure Principle?
Yes.
Oh.
Jesus Christ.
Smoking, dude.
The other day, that one of those slow jams from Pleasure Principle came on.
Oh.
I almost shed a fucking tear.
What a and record.
You, people, you're at home going, what the fuck are they talking about? Guys, Janet Jackson didn't become Janet Jackson because she was Michael's little sister.
No.
You ever have a doubt of who the fuck Janet Jackson was? It was Control.
Pleasure Principle. And
then one sucked dick. But she came back in 95.
Yeah,
with,
just Janet. It was called just Janet.
Janet.
Yeah.
Jesus,
yeah.
Joseph and Mary.
Smoking, dude. You know what's amazing about her? She almost had...
The song was called If.
Yeah, she had more hits than Michael for a while. You know what I mean?
Like
Michael just faded away, you know? Like,
well, listen, it was tough to follow Thriller.
Yeah, of course.
What are you going to do with Thriller?
Yeah,
I think after Thriller,
bad.
You put something bad.
Yep.
You know, was it bad?
Yep. And, you know, that had some hits, but then after that, he just kind of disappears, you know, and she just takes
what
it over.
What came out in 91? Remember the time.
Michael Jackson?
Yeah. Lee, have you ever seen that video? Remember the time.
Let's see here.
Just put in Remember the Time. Who sings that? Michael Jackson. This was when...
There we go.
This is when video... Rudy was on a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
And we were talking about...
I fucking love that guy. There it is.
We were talking about how they spent money on videos.
Oh, yeah, back then, like $1 million video.
Put the video on, Lee. Why are we Wikipedia video? Just put the video on.
Lee's so on that transmission for it.
Yeah, Lee's fucked up. I like
yeah,
it.
Yeah, me too.
You said you wanted to know what year it came out of.
No,
he gave you the year.
I gave you the year. You know me, dog. I'm not going to blow smoke up your ass.
Here we go.
It's YouTube and fucking Remember the Time. Yeah. This is one of those videos, Lee, where Michael Jackson went into a fucking meeting at wherever. Yeah. And he goes, I want to shoot this video.
Oh, remember this video? Yeah. Yeah. This shit is crazy.
This is crazy, Lee. Yeah, right there, that one.
Fucking 10-minute video costs like $10 million.
You know what that's like, Lee? You know what it's like for me to come to you and go, Lee, you got to give me 10 mil for a video. You
this,
know,
is, this video is insane.
You're like, Joey, we're minus 10 million right off the top?
Yeah, off the top.
Oh, watch this suckling video, Lee.
For a fucking video.
But MTV was that strong.
Yeah, they were. Oh, yeah.
Put the music on, Lee.
You're going to sell records.
MTV was that strong, Lee. If they played it, you bought it.
Yep. This thing's nuts. Straight Egyptian.
This cat cost him a half a mil. Look yeah. up, he's union.
Yeah, he's definitely union, that cat. Oh shit, then the tiger, baby tigers. Another 100 grand.
Alright, what's her name? Iman.
Oh.
This is Iman or Grace Jones? That's Iman.
She's great.
She's fucking a half a mil.
Eddie Murphy,
he's a mil.
Yep.
You know.
Yep.
Right there. Eddie Murphy, this is 1991 Eddie Murphy.
Eddie Murphy's in your video.
Look at him.
Golden
Child. Look at me for, Lee. Look at him.
Yeah.
All right. These guys are all in your fucking video.
I want to be entertained. Can my hero find some way
you
to
entertain
this,
Lee?
His queen?
Is ever here with us?
Awesome.
I don't think so, no.
How the fuck you hear Eddie Murphy do your video, Lee?
I know.
Wait, is this coming to America? What is this?
This is 91.
This is Michael Jackson's video, buddy.
Right. So, no, I haven't seen it now.
Look at this.
Yeah, fucking Magic Johnson. Magic Johnson.
Before the HIV.
Yeah, before HIVs, pre-HIVs.
Was it before the HIV?
Yep. Fake bald head.
Throw him to the lions.
Will they really do it now?
Hilarious.
I'm tough day to be a comic in those days.
Look at those hats.
Okay. Presenting Pyro.
Pyro. Off of his head.
That's cold.
Hilarious. Here we go. Moon dance in the sandals.
It's 91, 92, Lee.
And what is it you're going to do?
He had just killed the Thriller.
Yeah.
Then something else.
Bad.
He was quiet for a while. And then this shit came out. He was fucking people up, Lee Syatt.
Yeah. Look at this.
For them to give you this type of money... to shoot a video, you're like, listen, watch what I got for you.
Yeah, someone huge directed it, too, this video. Super nose job.
Jesus fucking Christ. I used to do comedy on Tuesday nights. And then after the comedy, you can leave this on me.
It's great.
And then after Tuesday nights, I used to take this girl to an Australian bar called the Outback.
Yeah.
And we karaoke. And I go up there and sing this for her.
Really?
Come on, Doug, will I bullshit you?
Fuck yeah.
I didn't fuck around. I'd do a little comedy routine. Could I karaoke the song?
Do you remember?
Fuck yeah, Doug.
Yeah.
She was young, out of college and shit.
Did you and I need a karaoke on the road?
I was in love. Yeah, it was crazy. Fucking crazy, guys. I was eating those Xanaxes.
Oh, yeah.
10 milligrams. I'd eat 10 of those motherfuckers.
Like M&M's.
Tremendous. Do a couple lines. I was right there. remember the time? I was 29 years old. I was dating a 22-year-old college graduate.
Oh.
I was an open micer. I didn't know dick about dick. I owed 50 G's, and I didn't give a fuck,
Jack. Who'd you owe 50 G's to, college?
Credit card.
Credit card, over. Yeah. Start hunting you down.
Oh, they were calling me at open mics and
Shit.
Yeah,
yeah. Hey, Jerry, who's this? This is the credit card.
You don't know what it's like to get to a place where you're doing comedy at.
Oh.
Or a comedy club, and somebody says, hey, the phone rang before. Somebody called for you, and you're like, holy shit, HBO called here finally for me.
Yeah.
They must have got my tape from somewhere. This is way before YouTube, Lee.
Yeah. They must have got my tape somehow.
And you get on the fucking phone, Lee, and it's fucking Discover card, and they're asking for their $44.95. You don't know what life is. So you just give somebody back the phone and go, oh, shit.
Oh, man.
They're calling me at my place of fucking business. They just embarrassed me in front of the club owner.
Yeah.
That, you know who's getting those calls? The chick in Denver.
Wendy?
Wendy.
Wow.
When I first started at Wendy, Wendy would tell me, Joey, I got a credit calling for you today. You know how embarrassing it was? Oh. But she liked me, so she overlooked it.
Yeah. Yeah, those fuckers. They pay those people to hunt you down, and then they just call all day.
They're tremendous at their job.
Yeah.
I applaud them that they had a team, they had to put a law together, because these guys are vicious.
Oh, yeah, they are. They do evil shit.
They're vicious, and that's their job. You know, then they keep selling the paper over and over, and you get a new ring. Like, it's funny. You would call me for 90 days, you'd be relentless. And if I wouldn't give you a dime, I wouldn't hear from you again ever. And then 60 days later, the phone would start ringing. Discover all over again. But now it was fucking Michael Riccio looking for me.
Yeah.
And I'd come home in the afternoon, dog, and there'd be 9 messages on my machine. 8.5 of them were fucking credit card companies.
Yeah.
It was scary. I thought I was done. I was done.
I was there. I remember when I did the Ice Cube movie, I got the money and I paid off the credit card and then I cut it up and I was like, never again. I mean, these fuckers call, they call your job, they call your cell phone and nonstop letters in the mail, all that shit. So when I paid it off, I never got another credit card. And I was like, fuck that, man. It was a night. It was something you buy like 15 years ago. You don't even know what you bought. It was so long ago. And you're paying on the interest still, you know? These credit cards are fucking demons, man. It's the complete... It's why I always tell people why they never go for their dreams. Because they get caught up in credit card debt. And then there's no way out ever. And then your dreams just go fucking away.
At one point for your dream, you know, you feel in the back of your mind, because you've heard so many stories, that's part of the dream. That's why you go into debt. Because in the back of your mind, this is not going to matter someday. You're going to have so much money that you'll be able to pay it all.
Yeah.
That was my reasoning with 3/4 of this shit.
Yeah.
I just lied to myself. I'm like, it doesn't matter. One day I'll see fucking Richard Pryor and he'll like me and bring me on tour and, you know, there'll be no suffering. I didn't know about the suffering that went with the journey.
Yeah.
And it was very interesting. And you're doing that journey. And that's why I said to you that, you know, you've been doing it for 7.5 years and you've made huge leaps and bounds because you had it. You've been put in weird fucking positions. One minute you were in the ha-ha.
Yeah.
And next minute you were opening up for Burr in a 900-seat theater.
Yeah.
And 2 weeks later you opened up for Marc Maron in a 1,000-seat theater. And you had to learn how to cut the fat. You know, you've learned. It's not that. And listen, you got into the store, which is a huge accomplishment. But like I said earlier, you take a plane to do a fucking spot, you know. I'm your age. I could take a plane to do a spot, but with the kid, now,
yeah.
I gotta fucking go somewhere in the end of September.
Yeah.
It's got to be a long week. I'm not sweating. I'm going to have a good time for 2 days with family.
There you go.
Gotta make a little pit stop in fucking Philly, you know what I'm saying, before I go to fucking Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
And see if a man about a dog.
Yeah, it's fucking... you know what? It's hard work, man. It's the hardest thing I've ever done. But I fucking love it, man. I love it. You know?
It's the hardest, easiest thing I ever done.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And Lee and I, we've had discussions on the podcast about hard work and whatever field you pick. As long as you're hardworking and you're honest and you do the right thing, you know, at one point it all has to flourish. At one point, if you really, really, really believe in your heart that this is what you genuinely want to do,
yeah.
If you want to draw murals and hopefully people give you $50, but if they give you $4,000, you ain't going to turn it down. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yep.
You're living that type of lifestyle. Eventually, somebody is going to give you $4,000 for a mural. And eventually, somebody is going to give you $8,000 because somebody gave you $4,000. Then somebody's going to give you $12,000 because somebody gave you $8,000. It's just you hanging in there. And it's just... it's such a bullshit thing to sell somebody, especially somebody young who's like, fuck you. Mm-hmm. People out there, you new people, Adam Sandler, I don't know nobody. Once the movie's done, they disconnect their phone. Nobody knows nobody. Right? No. Nobody knows nobody.
Once hey, the project's Cameron over. Dean, what?
Yeah, once the project's over, you don't know nobody.
Yeah, yeah.
Although, no, I'm not talking bad about Adam. Adam is bad.
He brought his crew all the time.
Yeah, no, he's always been a fucking good dude like that. That's why he's had a career. Because he knows how to cast people for years. He did a great job casting.
Yeah.
And, you know, right now he's on Netflix. People are bitching, man. Holy shit. People are pissed at this last fucking couple I don't even know what movies have been out. I'm not even up on Adam Sandler no more. Yeah. You know, I don't even know what he does. I know he went over to Netflix, and he releases pictures at Netflix. And I know that one of them had Whitney Cummings in it or something like that. So that's all the fuck I know. That's why Lee's around. Lee's supposed to keep me up on this. He makes believe he doesn't know. But he knows. He'll start stuttering in a minute. I don't know. And then he'll go, yeah. You know, in Netflix. Drop it on me.
I've heard the last one was actually pretty good at, but I haven't seen it yet.
The last one I saw was the one where it was Chris Rock and them. They all went to the camping, like the family house trip. And it's Chris Rock.
Kevin James.
Yeah, and what's his name? Rob Schneider, and they go on a camping trip, and it was fucking pretty funny, man. They go to the water slides, and Steve Buscemi's in it, and he crashes on the water slide, and he's in a fucking permanent body cast. Yeah. It was funny, man. And then they did a sequel to it. I didn't see it, but that shit was funny. That was the last one I saw. You know, I think that like Judd Apatow is kind of the new. Guy with that, like putting out the killer comedies nonstop, you know. I love all the stuff he's doing now, you know.
I don't even know what the fuck he's doing anymore. I know he's doing Crashing.
Now, Love. I'm on Love this season.
What's Love? That's an HBO show?
Yeah, it's fucking great.
No, isn't it Netflix?
Yeah, Netflix. Crashing's on HBO.
You're going to fucking promote a fucking show if you don't know what network.
No, Crashing's on HBO, and Love is on Netflix. But Love is about...
how many seasons?
It's going to be the third season. And it's fucking funny, man. It's shot over in Silver Lake. It's this hipster chick and a hipster dude, and they meet and by chance, and man, they're both fucking lunatics. It's a great show. I think it's one of the best shows that nobody's talking about. It's so fucking funny, man.
So it's the third season.
Third season. I'll be on season 3, March 1st.
And you got on from hanging out at the Comedy Store, doing spots at the store.
Fucking guy saw me do a set, man, and he was like, you know, we started talking, he's like, what do you got going? I was like, fucking nothing, dude. I got no manager. I got no agent. He's like, that's lunacy, man. And I go, yeah, I got nothing. A week later, I got a call. They're like, we got a role for you on Love. And I was like, fuck. This is incredible, man. And, you know, he let me come down there and just improv and shit. And then after, he's like, you were great, man. He made a call to a manager, checked this guy out, and... it got solid. Solid dude, man. great.
You didn't get it from sitting at home.
Fucking no.
You didn't get it because you were angry because they don't have enough white dudes at the fucking store.
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
You went down there like an animal, got on, saw he was on, he liked your shit, you spoke to him for a little while.
Yeah.
And people get pissed at you. Like I was telling you when I got up here, people look at that like, why the fuck does he get that and I don't get that?
Yeah.
That's when it starts at the store. Like I was always cool at the store until I started booking TV shit.
Yeah.
By the time I got to Spider-Man 2, I could feel the fucking hatred in my neck. Every time I walked in there, they would talk to me, but go, but look at this fucking fat fucking cocaine head. Or at least that's what I thought.
Right.
But I wouldn't think it if they didn't felt it. If I didn't feel it. You know what I'm saying? It's kind of weird to...
I never have any ill thoughts to anybody in the business.
No, me neither. It's kind of weird.
My enemies are cancer and heart attacks. And if somebody's doing good... It's just great for the biz, for the store and everything. I never go like, fuck that guy got that. I just never have that mentality. I really don't get that because that's how you go down. You end up going down that way because when you don't get stuff, you get angry and then you start to fucking do bad moves and then people don't want to work with you. You know, they're like, that guy's a negative dude or whatever. It's just like, we're all in this together, man. It should be us against the business.
Well, I'm going to tell you something. For me... I was here my first year, and I didn't think things were moving as fast as they should have. Like everybody else who comes here, that's young and stupid and thinks that this is made overnight. And you made a good point, but I'm too fucking high to remember. I don't even know. Help me out, Lee. You're the fucking...
Lee, you're not taking notes?
You're not the man behind the plan, Lee.
No, I have no plan at this point.
It's been one of those nights here on the podcast.
Fucking love it.
We had to push the envelope tonight. Last night we showed up, and then we found out midway that Lee, my man Dean Delray, had the wrong night. I told him the wrong night. I was high as fuck. And Lee and I sat here for a while. We talked shit. We kept the periscope up. Who gave a fuck? You know, we were already here.
Yeah.
And we tricked you motherfuckers, so here we are. But we went deep last night into the murky waters of the underworld. But tonight I had to take him a little deeper because he's been slipping lately. You know what I'm saying? No narcos, all this type of shit. He knows I love him, you know, but I gotta tell him.
I didn't know you had rules about watching narcos.
Oh, yeah. I can't
wait for season. I'm going to watch season 3.
You're the VP of the fucking church.
I'm going to watch it this weekend.
Your girlfriend's Mexican. You should already watched it, taking notes, so while you're watching it, you can ask how many people, what's this, 20 to life? What's this, 17 years? You know, you got to be ahead of the game if you want to be interesting. I'm just trying to tell you.
Yep. My point is...
Can't argue with that.
We're, you know, everybody down there at the store, man, it's just I think it's a great vibe. Everybody should just be, you know, fucking pulling for each other.
I know that, I tell you. When you come here, you're here for the first year, things ain't moving as fast as you want them to. And all of a sudden, something happens. You start looking at the people close to you. And you start seeing what they have. Instead of focusing on what they have, you should focus on, you know what I'm saying, what you're looking to get. But I got to tell you something. There's a period after you hear like at the 2-year mark where you look at your comic friends who you both call your peers. Where they
started at the same time.
Have been in comedy at the same time as you. And it was ever moving kind of quick, you kind of get mad at it. It's just a natural instinct.
Yeah.
And then he'll have something good happen, or maybe something good happen. And now you really get angry deep down inside. But one day you man up and you go, you know what, man? What am I being angry about? That's good. We're friends. If he got that, guess what I could do? So you kind of flip your mind to have the advantage here.
Yeah.
And that's what I started doing. I knew there was people getting shit that were terrible, but that's the way life is. There was nothing I could do.
Yeah.
There was nothing I could do. I don't control it. All I could do is keep getting on stage every night.
And get better.
And try to be the funniest cat I could be. And that's what I did. I kept my mouth shut. I didn't argue with nobody. I knew the recipe. I wanted to put it to the test.
Yeah.
You got to know the recipe and put it to the test. Tell you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that's what you're doing. Lee Syatt, what do you got cooking? Good looking. Look at you. How was your labor day?
It was pretty good. We went to the Ice House. That was fun.
Oh, yeah?
Saw our buddies, Steve Simone, Red Band.
I saw you this morning at fucking Marie E.T.
Yes, sir.
Sitting there like a judge eating fuck. Did you give the dog some bacon?
Paula did, yes.
Good. You're supposed to give him bacon. Did he bark at you?
Yeah, a little bit.
Did he make noises?
Yeah.
What kind of dog?
Was it very interesting?
He was adorable, yes.
You got a dog? I told you. Who the fuck do you think of? At least I had. Who do you think puts the fucking sizzle and mizzle? Uncle Joey does. You understand me? I've been going down there for years. They just started serving breakfast. Lee Syatt, my brother, tell him how good the bacon is.
The best bacon I've had in L.A.
Tell him about the potatoes.
Where are you going?
We go to our coffee shop, Marie ETC.
Where's that at?
Riverside and Colfax. It's an old coffee shop. It's been there. I've been going there for 10 years. Pastries, that type of shit. Don't touch it. When do they get a kitchen in there? I'm looking around. I'm looking at these sandwiches and this shit.
Yeah.
Finally, one day I go down and meet somebody in the morning. I look at the breakfast. I look at the bacon slices. And I go in there and I get the home fried potatoes, the real potatoes with onions and red peppers and green peppers. I'm like, wow. And they give you multi-grain toast.
Oh, shit.
And instead of giving you two eggs, they give you a 3-1.
Wow.
Just in case you're going to give somebody a stab in that. Am I lyingly? Am I lyingly?
No, they're delicious. And they cook them to order. And actually know how to cook it.
Yeah.
And they bring it out to you quick. You eat it outside. You have a cup of coffee. You write.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? While I'm waiting for the eggs, I make my calls. I outline what I'm going to write. Once I get the eggs, I stop what I'm doing. Bop, bop, bop. Once they leave, I map up the table. And boop, you put your little fucking iPod on. And you start a fucking typing. And there you go. You made a complete day.
Yeah.
After 2 hours, you're allowed to get up and stretch your legs to get circulation for the last 1,000 words of the day.
Where are you at on the new half hour?
The new half hour, I'm probably, honest, I'm probably 12 minutes in.
Yeah, that's good. Burr always told me if you could get 1 minute a week, just 1 minute a week, you're fucking getting there. And I thought, you know, when you look at it as 1 minute a week, it sounds more attainable than I need a new hour. 1 minute a week. That's how I look at it now. That's 4 minutes a month. You get up to 54 minutes a year right there? 1 minute a week. That's a cool way to look at it, right?
Yeah, no, it is. And it's true. It's absolutely true.
Yeah.
All the times I do those little rooms, that's part of it. Lee tapes it. And I will tell you something. It's a way I said something.
Yeah, you're so right.
It's
the cadence.
That's what you really learn.
Yeah.
You learn, wow, I can't believe I said that. I listen to those tapes and I fall backwards.
Yeah.
Because I forgot where that came from, how it came from, why it came from. I just was in such a personal zone because the pressure's off.
Yeah.
I don't like the store the pressure's on. I'm too old for the pressure to be on.
I'm the opposite. I love the pressure.
I love the pressure, but not when I'm trying to write new stuff.
I hear you. Because you get in there, like Burr was telling me a couple nights ago, I go, man, I'm trying to work these stories out. He's like, just go start bombing. And I go, yeah, but it's tough when you're fucking on at 9 o'clock and it's sold out. You know what I mean? Like, you got to go bomb somewhere else. So I bomb on the road now. That's why I go to New York, man. Just fucking get out in it.
Bombing eliminates bombing.
Yep.
100%. You know, the more you fucking bomb at something at first, the more bombs you're eliminating.
Absolutely.
And it sounds kind of weird. And it's percentages. It's all percentages.
Yep.
The more you get on stage, the more you're going to bomb. Okay, but then one day it's going to start going the other direction. And you're going to start bombing less and less and having a high percentage of jokes. And from time to time, you might, dog, I still remember, like, 93, 94. Was like my struggle.
Yeah.
I had started in 91 and I didn't really put it together until like 93. And that's when I was trying to make moves. They were good moves, but I just wasn't ready for the other moves.
Yeah.
I couldn't cover the spread. But I was trying, you know what I'm saying? I don't remember the exact memories, but I will tell you something. If you touch my heart, you can feel the beat that it's. My heart still remembers what those days felt like.
Yeah. You know?
Those are fucking rough days, man.
Yeah.
When all you want
to do. Trying to figure it out. Oh.
You know, right now I have to take that feeling. Like, if this is Anthony Robbins type shit. I gotta take that feeling and put it into my fucking brain now, in that part of your brain. And this will carry me. Like, this will make me go on the road every week of the month and fucking be a savage.
Yeah.
It's like when Curly smelled the wild hyacinth. It's the same fucking thing. Well, yeah, it's an amazing thing. You know, and you're part of it. Lee's part of it. Lee's seen it. Lee's see what consistency is.
Yeah.
There's no fucking nothing. What are you talking about? What do you got better to do? We do two of these a week.
It's great.
You ain't got time to do two of these a week. What else are you doing with your fucking life?
I love
you're
it.
Saving the world. You hanging out with that dude on 24. Huh?
Are you asking me?
Yeah.
He's cooked right now. I like it.
Sure he's cooked.
No, I don't know when I've ever said anything about the two we do.
We got... About the what?
I'm always here.
I never said you weren't. You're my brother, dog. Come on now. You were just saying you wanted to take an excursion.
I got some good Lee impressions. Here's one of them.
No, he made the noise before.
Well, but when he passed out, he took one wrong hit and couldn't even move.
He didn't pass out.
Up like a soldier.
He didn't pass out.
I wrote that shit out.
He went into a deep zone.
Yeah, I went into...
That's a complete different situation.
I was sitting there. If you look, the eyes are open. And I'm even answering. I'm going, yeah. Yeah. One of my favorite nights here ever. People talk about it. It's great when I go on the road. I like that one episode, dude, where you were fucked up on the 24 carat. It was great.
I'm happy you're back. You got any dates?
Oh, this is big, big important. I want to see what I can get going here. I didn't know when I booked this fucking date that it was 2 days after a 3-day weekend, but I'm headlining Bray on Wednesday night. Now, I'm not going to sit here and blow smoke up people's asses. There was only 10 tickets sold yesterday. So if we can get some people in the room, I'm going to be running an hour on Wednesday night. Even if we can get fucking 10 more, at least it's 20. It's a big fucking room.
Come on, if you're local, you ain't doing dick. Put those last $20 on the ATM card. You get paid on Friday next week. Fuck them.
Yeah, come to Brea this Wednesday night, September 6th, and see me run an hour, man. And I hope you guys come out, man, because I love running an hour. Well, yeah, I don't get to do it enough around here. You know, it's always on the road.
You know what? If you watch Dean, he's having a good time. You know, Timmy said that he watched you and you improved the last two times you've seen you.
Yeah.
The time before that and the time this time. So I could tell. I could tell where you're at. You're at the club. You're fucking loose, you know?
Yeah.
And that's how you get funny, my friend. So I congratulate you. And I want to open up the month with my brother, Dean Delray. Besides, we always talk a little fucking music.
I love it.
Did I give shout outs yet?
Nope.
No, hold on.
No, I think you did, didn't he?
No,
you went to the bathroom.
Watch you looking, sucker. Evil Dick, Johnny Five, Sandman, David Macca, Salvatore Sage, Chris DeMartson, Sean Quadri, and Jay Vomit Android.
Greg Riley.
You know I love you motherfuckers. Always. I appreciate you listening to the church. Now let me talk to you people about something, all right? And this is me also, all right? Throw out the stigma that being well-dressed will cost you the fortune. At 5'4 Club, they found a way to make great-looking clothes affordable for everybody, all right? Chris Paul and Mark Wahlberg use 5'4 Club, and 5'4 is featured in GQ magazine. Let me explain what 5'4 is. Each month, they send you a curated box of 2 to 3 items that are hand-picked to match the current season and your style. They've been helping men with fashion for over 15 years, and they ship to 100,000 men every month. They know what they're doing. So if you don't, that's okay. 5'4 Club will help you build your wardrobe 1 month at a time. Because when you look good, you feel good, all right? It's a fact of life. That's it. You're going to get $120 worth of clothes for $60 a month. Think about that. You can pause or cancel at any time. There's zero commitments, no commitments. And as a 5'4 Club member, you also receive up to 50% off items in their online shop and access to exclusive members-only items, free shipping, and size exchanges. Who's better than you? This is what I'm going to do. The holidays are coming. You want to look sharp. School's going back. You want to look sharp. This is how you're going to do it. Go to 54club.com right now and enter promo code Joey right now. And they'll give you 50% off your first month's package. Plus, you ready for this? A free pair of sunglasses. Who's better than you? You just hit the jackpot. By December, you'll be looking like Johnny Gambino in Heat. That's 50% off your first package at 54 Club. That's spelled F-I-V-E-4-F-O-U-R, Club, C-L-U-B.com, promo code Joey, 54club.com, promo code Joey. Trust me, if you look good, you're going to feel good. I'm going to tell you something else, too, all right? Listen, are you hiring? Do you know where to post your job to find the best candidates? Do you know how hard it is to find a qualified candidate, especially this time of the year with the holidays coming up? You know how hard it is? Listen, to be a successful business, you got to have the best candidates available to you. With ZipRecruiter, you can post your job to 100-plus job sites with just one click. Then their powerful technology efficiently matches the right people to your job better than anyone else. That's why ZipRecruiter is different. Unlike other job sites, ZipRecruiter doesn't depend on candidates finding you. It finds them. In fact, 80% of employers who post a job on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate through the site within one day. You listen to that? 24 hours. One day. Uno. No juggling emails or calls to your office. Simply screen, rate, and manage candidates all in one place with ZipRecruiter, easy-to-find dashboard. The holidays are coming. You're looking for help, right? I'll tell you what I'm going to do for you. Go to ZipRecruiter. They've been used by businesses of all sizes to find the most qualified job candidates with immediate results. And right now, the Church family can post jobs on ZipRecruiter for free, gratis, free. Just go to ZipRecruiter/church, C-H-U-R-C-H, .com. That's it. That's ZipRecruiter/church. .com, all right? That's ZipRecruiter/church. One more time to get a free... Listen, I'm going to give it to you one more time. So to try it, you got to go to ZipRecruiter/church. Okay? That's ZipRecruiter/church. You know I love you guys. I wouldn't hook you up with it. This is the best out there. I want to thank ZipRecruiter.com and also my main man at the 5-4 Club. You're going to look sharp. You follow me? I want to thank my man, Dean Del Rizzi.
Thank you so much for having me.
Looking under the counter like Stevie Wonder passed out. And I want to thank my man, Lee Syatt, always being here. My little fucking Goomba love. Look at him, looking sharp tonight. And I want to thank you guys. I'll see you this weekend. Saturday night, the Ice House. Working out with Uncle Joey. 7:30. You're out of there by 9. Just working on new stuff. $15. What do you give a fuck? Come on down. You're out of there by 9:30. Have a great week. Stay black. Be good.
Woo! Time.